bespoke radio for the masses.
Headline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found and is now in the possession of the Army.
If the game is rigged, change the game.
Game changer.
I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world.
This is Fade to Black with your host, Jimmy Church, on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
I need your help to get to the year 1985.
Listening to Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Network.
Good evening. Fade to Black. Bespoke radio for the masses. Today is Monday, May 16th, 137 days into the new year, 227 days left. We are live from a bunker somewhere in downtown Burbank, California. I'd like to welcome everybody listening all around the world, all across the United States. Hither and thither, to and fro, back and forth, up and down, east and west, north and south, far and near. This is Fade to Black. For KJCR, the Game Changer Network, and KGRA, the planet. I'm your oh-so-humble host, Jimmy Church. What is cracking, everybody? It's Monday. Got another great week of Fade to Black lined up straight ahead in front of us. It's going to be great. How does the team do it here? I have no idea. But we seem to pull it off, don't we? Tonight, Jason Martell is here. It's an ancient aliens, lost civilizations, and Mars kind of evening. Tomorrow night, very special presentation with John Rappaport. He's going to be here. We're going to do a full show on imagination. We talked about this last Thursday. And it is one of the great presentations ever. Imagination tomorrow night with John Rappaport. That is a not to miss show. And then Wednesday night, Dr. Louis Turi is here. Yeah. Nostradamus. He is the new Nostradamus. We're going to talk about predictions, his predictions, and how he got there. And that'll be Wednesday night. Very excited about this show. So that's Wednesday. What a great week. And then, of course, Thursday night, right back here, open lines Thursday with John Rappaport and his No More Fake Newsroom. And there you go. That's our week. We've got a great week lined up next week, too, as well. And very excited. And so let's go. Let's go. It's Monday. I'm in the chair. Had a great weekend. Spent Saturday night with Saturday day and Saturday night with Rita and Jolene Harrington and the alien hunter. Yeah, Daryl Sims flew in from Texas and we showed him how we do it in Burbank and we did kebabs. Yeah. And then yesterday, well, oddly enough, not tied to this show, this is something we had planned for a while, but we went down and hung out with Jason Martell and his better half, Taylor, and Doug Taylor as well. That sounded kind of weird. And Serena Wright Taylor. We went down and cruised around on a lake on a boat, on a pontoon boat, and had brunch. And there's a symphony orchestra playing on the shore. So we got to sit there on a boat and watch that. Beautiful day. And so that was our weekend, nice and relaxed, which the reason why I bring that up is I'm back in the chair today. It was one of those weekends that I just wanted it to continue, just hanging out with Rita and everybody was just, it doesn't get any finer than that. So with that, I'm rested. I have no excuses. We've got another week to do. And then it's off at the end of the week, off doing Coast to Coast. And more on that in a little bit. And strangely enough, again, I think my guest this week, let me look. Who do I have? This week is Graham Hancock and Daryl Sims. Yeah, there you go. And so that'll be this weekend. And then next weekend, back at Coast 2, and my guest star. Who's next? Stephen Greer. Stephen Greer will be the next week on Coast. So there you go. We are very busy. And then after we wrap up these next 2 weeks, then we head out to Contact in the Desert, of course. All right. So there you go. Very, very busy times around here. And that's why this was like the last weekend of rest that we're going to have for about the next 30 days. But we got it in. Sleep and fun is what we did this weekend. Follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. Right now, hashtag F2B is the sandbox, Facebook, YouTube. Just go over to JimmyChurchRadio.com and you can follow, like, and subscribe. You can also email throughout the show tonight, Jimmy@JimmyChurchRadio.com. Any questions or comments during the show, you know what to do. Hashtag F2BQ is fade to black questions. F2BQ. All right. I keep TweetDeck live to my left. It is live throughout the show. Let's see here. What? Oh, you guys are still talking about, what is that? Michael Shermer? Man, I kind of went off on Michael last week, and I did too. I mean, it was all deserved. And, you know, I know he's probably a nice guy, but, you know, it's kind of weird. It's not Shermer, and I'm going to talk about that in a little bit here, but it's not Shermer. It's the idea behind Shermer. And I will get to that in just a bit. I want to clear up some stuff. Check out our sponsors. That's what you do. You support the show by supporting our sponsors. Life Change Tea, GetTheTea.com. Go. Just click. The specials page is right there on their website. Use the promo code Jimmy and get to ordering. Yep, and I did my Moringa and I did my colostrum today. I did the Moringa drops, which I am now addicted to, by the way. They don't put that disclaimer on the package. Stuff tastes good. And the Studio Dome Surround Sound Stereo Package, TWS True Wireless Stereo, right now High Fidelity Stereo System, 2SB B2 speakers and power, cables, everything. Hard shell case, $129. Best deal on the net. Use the promo code JCRTWS, 60% off of the normal price of $399. I do want to just click on the banners at Jimmy Church Radio. I want to thank everybody that ordered T-shirts, by the way. We sent out a pile. And when I say pile, today. And I was just thinking about that as we did that. You know, how cool. You know, you just kind of lose sight of everything. So everybody enjoy your shirts. And thank you. That just helps support the show. Okay? Contact in the Desert is coming up in 2 short weeks. I cannot believe it. Today's the 16th. Kicks off on June 3rd in Joshua Tree, California. Just mentioned Graham Hancock. He's going to be there. Bavall, Linda Moulton Howe, Giorgio, Wilcock, Von Daniken, of course, George Noory and Jim Mars and David Hatcher Childress, Danny Sheehan, Mike Barra, Laura Eisenhower, and 40 other speakers. I could sit here and start naming everybody and get around to it. Also, the Roswell Festival, which is June 30th through July 3rd in Roswell, New Mexico. And the links are over at JimmyChurchRadio.com. And then shortly after that, which is August 13th and the 14th, is the Awareness Life Expo at the Crown Plaza Hotel in Sacramento, California. And there you go. Lori McDonald's going to be there. Patty Greer, Holly Cook, Glenn Caston. And so the links are there. Crown Plaza Hotel, Sacramento, California, the Awareness Life Expo. With that, let's get this show cracking. Birthdays today. Pierce Brosnan is 63, and he will always make the list because of the movie The Matador. Nirvana bassist Krist Novoselic is 51. And looking at that today, so I went and looked and did a little research. The 10 most richest bassist in the world. Yeah, I did it. And so I just want to check this out. And it comes in, Chris comes in at number 10 at $40 million, right? Bass player. No doubts, Tony Kanal came in at 45 mil. Geezer Butler, number 8 at 65. John Paul Jones, Led Zeppelin, 80 million. I was kind of surprised about that, kind of low. Flea comes in at 115. Adam Clayton from U2, only $150 million. How's that possible? Doesn't even make sense, does it? Pink Floyd's Roger Waters, $270 million. Gene Simmons, $300 million. Sting, $300 million at number two. And number one, of course, Paul McCartney, $1.2 billion. And also today, I ran into this guy. He's an old friend. Ran into this guy the other day, and I'm wishing him happy birthday. Tried to get him on the phone tonight to wish him a happy birthday in person. We didn't quite pull that off before showtime. And that is Danny Trejo is 70 bleeping two. And I saw him just two weeks ago. And, you know, I had a quick chat and said our goodbyes And then I find out today he's 72. And I mean, I was face to face with this guy 2 weeks ago. There's no way I would have thought he was 72. It's shocking to me. There you go. Happy birthday, Danny. And on this day in history, 1964, Mary Wells gives Motown Records its first number one hit with My Guy. Yeah, 1964. Fader fact, George Lucas, creator of Star Wars, claims he has not used the internet since 2000. He has not used the internet in 16 years. That is a fader fact. Tonight we have Jason Martell. It's going to be an Ancient Aliens, Lost Civilizations, and we're going to throw in some Mars for good measure. It's what we're going to do tonight, tomorrow night. John Rappaport is here with a very special presentation on imagination. Wednesday night, Dr. Louis Turi is here. And then Thursday, Fader Night, again with John Rappaport and his No More Fake Newsroom. All right. Now, so a couple of weeks ago, somebody sent me this quote. And I almost used it and stuff. But then I decided to save it for good reason. But here it is, one of the greatest quotes ever. Great minds discuss ideas. Average minds discuss events. Small minds discuss people. And that's Eleanor Roosevelt. It's one of the greatest quotes ever. Great minds discuss ideas. Average minds discuss events. Small minds discuss people. And the reasons are many for me to bring this up tonight. But for all of you out there, if you lived by this, made this your mantra and just repeated this every single day, you would be run the cleanest life you could ever run. I was talking to, and it went down about a week ago. I haven't told anybody about this, but I was talking with a show host out there outside of this, a big show host, national radio show, so forth, about criticisms, right? And personal attacks and how those personal attacks affect his mind, right? And that he got caught up in reading criticisms about himself and about somebody else and that were attacking people and himself instead of the idea or what they were about, and that it affected his show performance that day. Right. And I started to think about, you know, that there are a few mistakes that you need to avoid, especially in radio or television. And that is, right before you go on the air, is go out and read some tweets or read some email or just read a blog somewhere, or go on a forum and just read some stuff because it's going to mess you up. It's going to mess you up, and you're going to be thinking about that. Never do it. Don't do it. Because people that do that, it comes from anybody that talks smack about another individual, it's a small mind. That's what it is. It's smaller than yours. Ignore it or laugh at it. That's my advice. Ignore it or laugh at it because it's below you. And that way, you know, if you make that mistake, then you can hopefully not think about it. And then just do your thing, man. Do your thing because the small mind is trying to throw you off your game. That's it. And if they throw you off your game, you have won. Now think about this. This applies to you. Everybody in the audience. You don't have to be a broadcaster or anything. And that's not what I'm talking. I'm talking about you personally. Because if somebody does that, then you are thrown off your game. And they have won. I'll give you an awesome example of how this could apply to everybody. All right? There's a really messed up thing that you can do with golf or baseball or basketball, anything like that where there's timing involved, right? Just go up to somebody. He's getting ready to drive. He's getting ready. He's in the first tee box, right? He's getting ready to drive. Or somebody's at the free throw line, right? He's getting ready to shoot. Just go up to him right before they swing and just go, hey, dude. You know, on your backswing, do you inhale or exhale? That's all you got to do. And that way, and before you do that, bet the guy $100 on the round of golf, right? Bet the guy $100 on your game of 21. That's all you got to do. That's the way you win the bet. Because he will never be able to swing correctly for the rest of the day, maybe for a month. Because now you've thrown him off his game. He's not thinking about his game. He's thinking about inhaling or exhaling. Hey, man, do you inhale or exhale when you're shooting a free throw? That's it. It's over. It's game over. And that's an example of what I'm trying to tell you now. If somebody says something to you, some personal attack, whatever it is, it's to throw you off your game. You just can't do it. Great minds discuss ideas. So if somebody comes up to you and wants to discuss an idea and argue about it, that's different. That's great. Do it. Bring it. It's game on. Have your meeting of the minds. That's the way life works. When somebody comes up to it, whenever, anything is posted that attacks a guest or a friend and their name is in it, deleted, done. No emails ever come back in, no posts, no this, no that. We don't play that around here. The last thing we need to do is get weighted down with negativity with personal attacks. It just doesn't, it's a waste of time. It comes from a small mind. I like to have fun. That's what I do. So now I'm bringing up this whole Michael Shermer thing that I brought up last week. Yeah, I got an email about it. Jimmy, you're so right. You know what? I was so wrong. I was wrong. It wasn't about Michael Shermer. It was about skeptics. That was my point. I should have just taken Shermer's name out of it. No, screw Phil Klass. He's dead. He doesn't matter. But it's the idea. It's the idea of skeptics and how they play their game. That is what irritates me. And that we have one. They don't have really any room. Rita and I, last week, we went and listened to a bunch of skeptics stuff, right? After the show. Back at home. And we're listening to some things. And she goes, man, she's just getting angry. What are you listening to this for? I said, because you need to know how retarded skeptics are. That whole society is just retarded. You know, it is. And she said, no, I've heard enough. I've heard enough. And I thought that she would understand where I was coming from. But the point is, skeptics and how they deal with stuff, it's frustrating and it drove her crazy. And I try to say, that's what drives me crazy. Exactly this. And then we ended up turning it off and temperatures came back down and blood pressure came back down and it was all good. It's because it gets under my skin. All right. So that's why I did this quote tonight. Great minds discuss ideas. Average minds discuss events. Small minds discuss people. So that's why I don't have time for when, especially a caller or an email or a guest or anybody around me at all. As soon as they go into that zone, I check out. Mentally, I check out. I can't do it. I can't waste time because it's not worth it. It's not discussing the issue. And the issue is the idea. And that is where we come from on this show. That's why there's no negativity. There's nothing involved. There's no darkness. And it's very important to me. The growth and the happiness of this show and the family is because nobody gets that from this show. You know, when people that come in and listen for the first time and are hoping for that kind of stuff and it's not here, okay, if it's not for you, fine. You know, and another reason why I brought this up today is because it happened again today where I saw something, you know, that was directed at this show. And it was like the things that were discussed or pointed at a personal level, not at me, at a guest. It's just like, dude, you know, why? And that's it. Bounced. Done. And I just don't get it. And if that's why you are listening to the show, because you're hoping for some of that, it ain't ever going to be here. It's just not. Oh, man. I do walk around with flowers hanging out of my pockets. I swear to you, I just don't have time for it. So one more time, great minds discuss ideas. That's what we do. Average minds discuss events. And we do a little of that because I'm kind of average. Small minds discuss people. Always remember that. I don't go there. And if you want to bring it and go there, you get bounced. And you should always live your life this way. All right? Are we cool? Is everybody with me? I you know what? I ignored Twitter through that whole rant. Nothing written, no bullet points. Just a little bit of anger. Just a little bit. All right. Check this out. I got the biggest news of the week. Are you guys sitting down? Are you guys sitting down? Yeah, Les says in an infinite corner. Les knows what that is all about. In what could be one of the biggest changes to its format ever, Twitter Inc. announced that it's reportedly planning to stop counting photos and link URLs toward the 140-character limit in tweets. Yay! Yay! The change could come as soon as within the next 2 weeks. It was announced today. You know, there's nothing worse than Twitter. You go and post a picture, and then you can, you got two letters left. It's the worst. Well, not anymore. All right. How cool is that? URLs and all of that. Real long URL, which we have all the time, right? Some big long thing is not going to count against it. How cool is that? Now, does that change TweetDeck and the sandbox? Huh? Yeah, it does, doesn't it? You guys are fired up. All right. Despite changes to the law, the U.S. National Security Agency can still request metadata from tens of thousands of private phones if they are indirectly connected to a phone number of a suspected terrorist. And I'm putting quotes around suspected and terrorist. All right. The study is one of the first to quantify the impact of policy changes intended to narrow the agency's previously unfettered access to private phone records, which was first revealed by Edward Snowden back in 2013. Now, 4 years before Snowden went public, the U.S. National Security Agency legally obtained metadata not only from suspects' phones, but also from those in their contacts. And their contacts, contacts, and their contacts, 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 in order to trace terrorist networks. Well, that was their excuse. This metadata included information about whom a user has called, when the call was placed, and how long these calls lasted. Well, today, federal rules permit the NSA to recover metadata from phones within two hops of a suspect. Now, listen to me. Two hops. Two layers out. Which means someone who called someone who called the suspect in the past 18 months. Previously, federal regulations were more generous, permitting recovery of metadata from three hops, dating back 5 years. Now, what does two hops mean? Two hops means if your contact list is, you know, average, it can multiply to 25,000 individuals legally without a warrant. That's frightening. And I just don't feel right about it. Well, Matt Blaze, write this down, a professor of computer and information science at the University of Pennsylvania, noticed a Google Maps SUV in the Philadelphia Convention Center tunnel. Okay? The Google Maps car with the Google Maps sticker on it. Upon closer inspection, he noticed it wasn't a Google Maps car, and he tweeted the picture. It turned out it was a Philadelphia Police Department surveillance van, or SUV, bearing a Google Maps logo. Listen to me. Seen in the center city on Wednesday, it was not authorized to use the logo. That's what police officials are saying today. Well, and this is the quote from the police department. We have been informed that this unmarked vehicle belongs to the police department. However, the placing of any particular decal on the vehicle was not approved through any chain of command, end quote. That's according to police spokesman Lieutenant John Stanford. And he continues, once this was brought to our attention, it was ordered that the decals be removed immediately. What does Google have to say? Google confirmed they didn't have permission. And I'm quoting Google with their release today. We can confirm that this is not a Google Maps car and that we are currently looking into the matter. Now, how crazy is that? What actually happened, and this is where it gets nuts, that police, it was an SUV, by the way. It says van in the, but when you look at the picture, and you can go to our Facebook page and check it out. They had a friggin' license plate reader sitting there at the arena. All of the cars that were going in were getting photographed. All of their license plates read for a warrantless search. And they got caught. And on top of that, doing that with a high-speed license plate reader, right? They had a Google Maps logo on the car. How uncool. If it's me, heads are rolling. And it just seems like Google's going to let this go. I wouldn't. Man, this is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Tonight, Jason Martell is right here. Tomorrow night, John Rappaport and his Imagination Special. And then Wednesday night, Dr. Louis Turi is here. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. This is Fade to Black on the Game Changer Network and KGRA, The Planet. I'll be right back with Jason Martell right after this. Stay with us.
You're listening to Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
Fade to Black will now pause for alien identification.
The station that talks the net, KGRA Radio.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National tax experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. It doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously, give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444. Or go check out their website, www.nattaxexperts.com. That's NATTAXEXPERTS.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
Health in America is becoming a top priority. Or maybe I should say, good health in the world is becoming a top priority. Maintaining a healthy body can be challenging. How about letting Life Change Tea help you? Our tea you make, you drink, and you benefit. Our unique blend of 8 different herbs helps you maintain good digestion, a healthy colon, and detoxes harmful toxins and parasites out of your body. And you know what? It tastes great! If you're wanting a change, a life change when it comes to health, log on to GetTheTea.com. That's GetTheTea.com. Or you can call us at 928-308-0408. That's 928-308-0408. When you log on to our mobile-friendly website, you can read all the numerous testimonies of how Life Change Tea has helped so many people. We carry many, many beneficial products that help your health and keep you on track. GetTheTea.com. Kind of gets in your head, doesn't it? GetTheTea.com.
9 out of 10 geneticists agree.
Fade to Black is not your father's radio show. On the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the planet.
Hi, this is Chase Kletsky with Fate Magazine Radio, and you're listening to Jimmy Church and Fade to Black on the Game Changer Network and the KGRA digital broadcast station, where the Fader Knots rock.
Hi, this is Rob Reiner from Anvil, and you're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
What's up? I'm Chris.
What up? This is Kyle Massey,
and you're listening to Jimmy Church Radio.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Bespoke radio for the masses. On the Game Changer Network, KGRA the planet. Tonight, Jason Martell. Tomorrow night, John Rappaport and the Imagination Presentation. Wednesday, Dr. Louis Turi is going to be here. Thursday night, Open Lines. But tonight, it is Jason Martell. And for over 15 years, Jason has been one of the leading researchers and lecturers specializing in ancient civilization technologies. Mr. Martell's research has been featured worldwide on numerous television and radio networks such as Discovery Channel, Sci-Fi, and BBC. He is currently a regular guest, as we know, on the show Ancient Aliens, which I believe I'm going to ask Jason this in a second. We're closing in or closing on season 11 and throwing in 12. Crazy. What a great run on the History Channel. His latest book is Knowledge Apocalypse. And lecturing throughout the world, he has dedicated his studies to ancient artifacts, Planet X, ancient astronauts, and the structures on Mars. We're going to discuss all of this tonight. Today, he is planning stages. He's in the planning stages of several groundbreaking international research expeditions, and they will focus on gaining access to ancient locations, ancient artifacts, and other archaeological relics not currently accessible to the public. His website is, of course, xfacts.com. And I would like to welcome back to the show our good friend, Jason Martell. Jason, good evening.
Hey, Jimmy. Thanks so much for having me back on.
You know, normally I would say, hey, man, what have you been up to? But we just hung out yesterday. So,
you know exactly what I've been up to.
Yeah, exactly, man. And we had a great time, and thank you for that. It was just awesome just hanging out and not talking UFOs for a day, you know, just cruising the lake and having a good time. It was awesome. Oh, hey, what's up with the drone footage? Did you download it?
I did not even look at it yet, but I should. But you were quite a sport because I don't think we would have been able to launch the boat or dock without your assistance there. I'm sorry we almost left you on the dock.
Yeah.
But, you know, you can only keep one foot on the boat and one foot on the dock so far.
You know what was funny when that happened? Jason's referring to the boat pulled away, and I got one foot on the boat, one foot on the dock, and I was trying to make up my mind, jump on the dock or jump on the boat, and then the next thing you know, I was almost in the water. And this, you know what went through my mind at that moment, Jason? Saving my cell phone. That's what I was like, what do I do? Do I throw my cell phone on the dock? Do I throw it to somebody on the boat? What do I do? It's so funny, man. What your brain does. Yeah. So anyway, great time yesterday, and thank you for that. What I would like to do, and that drone footage, yeah, I would like to see it. Jason's got this really cool drone with a high-def camera that he was running around and managed to keep it out of the water, too, which was pretty impressive, Jason. Me, I'd have to go out and get it out of the water. But, yeah, I want to see that footage. Drones flip me out, man. What the quality of what they can shoot and how it gets done these days is, and that technology, how it has advanced is incredible. Have you seen Brian Forrester's drone footage?
Yes, him and Gary Holloway, Gary Holloway's footage for Brian is very impressive. And the DJI Phantom and some of those drones they're coming out with on the higher end are incredible. But there's also some lower end, you know, in the $100 to $500 range. And it really is changing the game for people to be able to capture great footage.
Yeah, that's my next move is I've got to go there, man. I've got to get me one. And it's one of those toys, if you know what I mean, you know, big boys toys. It's one of those toys that is not going to just, you know, you're going to use it for a day and then it's going to get packed away for a couple of years. You know, that is something that is just totally, totally cool. And that's my next move.
It's really been an interesting tool for places where you find, let's say, petroglyphs or something on a face of a wall or a mountainside. And, you know, you don't want to hire a helicopter crew and a camera crew. That's expensive, dangerous, scaling the cliff. But to send a drone, right? So it is a useful tool in the right systems and purposes, definitely within the realms of the ancient astronaut or archaeological purposes.
When you see drone footage of the Sphinx or the Great Pyramid or any of the stuff in, well, any megalithic structure, but when, because we're so used to and acclimated to the images of the Sphinx and of the Great Pyramid, and that's one thing in 2D, but to go and look at some high def drone footage of that, and it's like you are there, but then you start to appreciate the size, the quality, and so forth that you just don't get out of, normal, high def still images.
Yeah, that's definitely true. And, you know, a lot of these sites, Jimmy, too, it's really interesting to take a kind of a different perspective sometimes, not just what you see on the ground or what you see at 30,000 feet standard flight, but taking some of these different flight patterns or being able to analyze something on the side of the pyramid way up there. These drones literally do have useful technology, at least for our research purposes.
Have you seen also GoPro is another, revelation. And did you see the GoPro footage of the guy running up the Great Pyramid? I think it came out like 2 months ago.
I did not see that, but that sounds pretty interesting.
Yes. And so, of course, I'm sure he got arrested on his way down. But what you do have is his footage of him going up, and it's pretty breathtaking. And the other thing is, dude, if you slipped and fell, you don't stop until you hit the ground.
Yeah, you're done.
But at the top, what I did when he was at the top looking around was freezing the frames and looking down at the rocks at all of the everybody that's carved initials with the dates on it. And it's all over on the top of the Great Pyramid. And you don't get to see that often. And I was freeze framing all of that. I was looking for, like, Napoleon was here,
Oh, that'd be awesome.
Yeah, right.
Well, Geese is obviously a great starting point even for tonight's discussion and to, kind of asking that question, which Ancient Aliens and many shows have been doing, is were these structures built by aliens or were they built by us?
Let's start right there. That's a perfect starting spot. And before we go there, congratulations, but Is season 11 the one that we're seeing now on Ancient Aliens?
You know what? I literally, the producers of the show are referring to Wikipedia now, because the problem we have is that the History Channel counts the episodes and specials, right? There's been like seasons and then specials in between seasons. So there's a kind of a count discrepancy between the production company, Prometheus, which is, you know, who we all were, you know, the team who's actually, you know, making the shows, that count is different than what the History Channel counts. So at this point, it's kind of like, you know what? Here's the standard answer when asked. We've done over 100 episodes, and we continue to do more.
Wikipedia says season 10 was 2015, and season 11 is running now.
Okay, well then that sounds about right. I mean, season 11, we're into our second episode of season 11. I believe there's 12 new episodes, so it's pretty exciting.
Yeah, that's a pretty crazy run, and you guys are shooting now, right? So that would be season 12.
No, we're still wrapping up this season. So I know Giorgio mentioned he was doing some filming this week, and that is for this current season that we're into. So they literally film right up to the last minute during the season release of getting these episodes out.
Wow,
so
that's crazy.
When you see fresh content, it's literally like hot off the press.
Yeah, so they've got the production machine, the machina, completely set up, so they are able to shoot, get it into the edit bays, and crank it out and release it as an episode that fast.
Yes, and sometimes it puts a little pressure on us to obviously be able to pinch hit and have, you know, information in a kind of a moment's notice. And some of these topics do present a challenge even to us, because they're new areas that we're exploring. I mean, there's been several areas that were really not on the radar until some of the research that was done through the show of Ancient Aliens. And so a lot of these sites, I think, will continue to branch out into new discoveries. And what's always been fun for me, Jimmy, is that I've literally gone over a slight conversion process in my time looking into these topics. I've always known there's an alien connection, and I'll stand to that today. But what I'm seeing is a broader pattern of connected societies where they all seem to share knowledge that might not always be extraterrestrial, of extraterrestrial influence.
And let's start with the Great Pyramid. My opinion has changed somewhat, not much though, over the last 20 years or maybe even my lifetime of looking at the Great Pyramid. But the one thing that I've always felt that looking at it is that it looks the same today as it probably did at year zero, right? And if that is the case with those 2,000 years that have passed, then if it was allegedly constructed at 2500 BC, how did it age to make, you know, to what it was at year zero in that 2,000 years, 2500 years? It doesn't really fit to me. It has always looked really, really old to me, and it's probably going to look, you know, 10,000 years from now, it's going to look like it does today. You understand what I'm saying? So
I do.
I just don't feel, I've never felt like we have been told the truth about it, that it is just not that young. It can't be that young.
Giza has some very interesting physical properties about it that do lend scrutiny to that 2500 BC date. Now, everyone in the ufological or ancient astronaut circles know, you know, Graham Hancock, Robert Bouval, they discovered the fact that the three stars of the Orion's Belt essentially line up right above the three pyramids. Essentially, the Giza Plateau, the three pyramids, are a terrestrial map mirroring the Orion constellation. And so at a specific date, this alignment occurs, where there's actually two alignments, which I'll tell you about here. But so Giza, the three pyramids, are perfectly lined up with the Orion constellation, and the Sphinx is gazing directly east into the constellation of Leo, which, of course, is a lion. So this happens at 10,500 BC. So there's a little bit of a gap there, Jimmy, an 8,000 years difference, where, yes, we probably have more of a closer realistic date at 10,500 BC, or probably much older. So there's two reference points that I like to use in my research. One is the astronomical reference, like we just used there. Somebody, somehow, built the Giza pyramids to align to the Orion constellation in 10,500 BC. Whether that was the date they were built or not, that's a standard point. Another thing that we can look at, though, is the geological evidence. So all of the stories and depictions of the pyramids show the pharaoh being able to literally walk down the banks of the pyramid and be at the foot of the Nile and step aboard his boat.
Right.
So today, if anyone looks on a Google map where the Nile is compared to the three Giza pyramids, you'll see that there's a miles of difference in range. And so for that time, for the Nile to meander away from the pyramids, that's geological evidence that we can also use to substantiate the actual date.
And what kind of,
and there's many other sites that have those type of characteristics.
What kind of date? Okay, let's talk about two dates here. One, let's go back to the astrological side. At 10,500 BC, we know that the alignment was there, right, with Orion. But now, when would the next cycle going back, would Orion have aligned the same as it would have at 10,500 BC?
That's a good question. You know, I don't really roll it back on a continual pattern for looking for points of intersection, other than to see that at that time in 10,500 BC, there seemed to be other megalithic monuments that are put into question.
Sure.
Stonehenge, Machu Picchu,
Gobekli Tepe. Yep.
Gobekli Tepe, now at 13,000 years old. So there's a lot of sites that seem to kind of cross into that strip of a time frame where we would say something great happened in the past. Was it a great flood? Was there a great cataclysm of some kind? But there definitely seems to be a breaking point in this larger cycle of time, which we now know all the ancients were aware of. Today we call it precession, right? The breakdown of the heavens into 12 constellations, the 12 houses of the zodiac. We now know that the ancients just simply used this as a large celestial clock, looking at a larger cycle of time. So there does seem to be a breaking point from when we were in the last golden age, which was probably somewhere between 10 to 13,000 years ago, that there also could have been, unfortunately, overlapping some great cataclysms, cataclysm as well.
So the 10,500 date, which BC, by the way, that date, which does seem to be, and it's corroborated more and more and more on every continent. That's what we're starting to see here. But also, and this is where I call BS on any archaeologist statement on this, sometimes yep. I get tongue-tied, that it is impossible, is that was a very serious breaking point for man himself. We're talking about hardcore Stone Age era man, and also where the confusion starts. Also, severe intelligence that Stone Age man shouldn't have had when it comes to the stars and being able to do this, because those guys didn't have any tools or didn't have any, you know, maybe they had axes that they were making out of flint, but
sure.
but they certainly didn't have that leap in knowledge to make this happen. But the problem is we have the evidence that it did occur. Right. So where how do we connect this two together unless they were either given that information or there was a civilization that was obviously much, much smarter than what Stone Age man was?
And that seems to be the case. I mean, nothing's ever black and white, it seems, with these answers, Jimmy. You know, you mentioned Stone Age cultures and such. Well, there seems to be many cultures even today that exist that several still even outside the umbrella of technology, like the Dogons in Africa, A lot of these cultures have retained cultural information about astronomical references that our science today has corroborated, as you mentioned, and it's kind of overwhelming. Now, just as the Egyptians had this knowledge of Orion and the pyramids having this alignment, we also have this same knowledge by the Dogon tribe, not only significantly paralleling the Egyptian idea of Orion making symbols on the ground and things that line up and mimic the Orion's belt, but even another star constellation called Cirrus A and B that you can't even see from a naked eye. You know, there's no way to see this without an assisted telescope that it's actually a Cirrus A and B.
Mm-hmm.
And so somehow they have this information that there's actually – that there's people that come from this system. And they have depictions and things that they've held as cultural knowledge – that is extremely accurate. So, of course, you'd have to ask, well, someone who had seen this or knows had to have told them. And then, of course, it makes it very easy to jump to the alien hypothesis. But as you mentioned, there's a lot of evidence that there's some older race, probably not entirely human. This is where it gets tricky. But there's some older race, Jimmy, and that has affected all the great ancients we have today, the Mayans, the Egyptians, Sumerian, right? Everything in the Semitic languages. It seems that every culture of an ancient origin that we still have a record today seems to have a piece of influence from some lost great civilization that was once here.
I say it all the time, and I want this idea to be driven home to everybody. There isn't really any new information, right? Everything for you, Jason, for me, right? We're taught, right? Everything is taught. You are taught. You're taught from your elder who is taught. And when it comes to Sumeria, Mesopotamia, or Egypt and the Giza Plateau, or down in South America and Peru, the ability to do megalithic structures, to carve languages, art, anything that you can point a finger at is taught by somebody else. So when you have this leap between 2500 BC and let's say Gobekli Tepe, well, wait a minute, that Gobekli Tepe wasn't supposed to be there to begin with. So who taught the people in the Sumerian culture about the wheel? Who taught them about farming? Who taught them how to chafe wheat? Who taught them these things, right? Well, it came from before. And now that we have Gobekli Tepe, well, let's stop there for a second. Somebody taught the constructors of Gobekli Tepe how to do what they were doing. And that is the evidence of a very high technological civilization that was before Gobekli Tepe, because they were taught that. They didn't invent how to quarry rocks.
Yep. I mean, what are you going to do, too? A lot of these sites, Jimmy, there's like Pumapunku, Teotihuacan, Tiwanaku. A lot of these sites, the way that the stones are cut and stuck together without the use of mortar, it really defies logic. And some of the size of these stones, we're starting to get into, you know, like as you mentioned, megalithic structures. They all seem to have a commonality of being built not as places to, have like wars or shield themselves from armies. 90% of these megalithic spots are built to look at the stars.
Right.
Right. They're monitoring something that's been happening for thousands of years, changes that they use to somehow track future events and knowledge of past events with the reassurance that the answer was always in the stars.
And the other thing, and you just touched upon this, but the similarities that you have between the construction at Pumapunku and Giza, throughout Peru, by the way, and Mexico, and around the world, but the way that these stones are cut and placed, it's just like, wait a minute, they did this 8,000 miles away, and it's exactly the same. And there has to be some type of source for this information. You know, it's coming from a single point source because they are way too similar. It's not coincidence.
And some of these sites, you know, in Mexico, Chichen Itza, some of these pyramids, you know, we have the serpent god and Kukulcan and Quetzalcoatl and all these various, you know, gods that they build monuments to. And some of these monuments, again, we can see these astronomical events repeat, you know, where literally they've built the pyramid in some circumstances to be hit by a light, creating a shadow effect, where only on a certain day of the year are you able to see a representation of the god that forms as like he's descending down the stairs, or various other circumstances where the astronomical alignments do repeat and allow for these events to also be known as a cyclical return. The thing is that some of these events and some of these cycles are on a scale of time around 24,000 years, between 24 and 26,000 years. There's a debate, you know, with modern precession and ancient precession, but let's just call it 24,000 years. So we're talking about a very large cycle of time. And so a lot of these things, when they pinpoint things in the past that say, well, you know, something's going to happen in 1,000 years from now, these are very difficult timetables even for us now to comprehend.
Well, if that civilization wasn't around 24,000 years ago or 22,000 years ago, where did the information come from?
Yeah, that's the point, Jimmy, is it definitely had to have come from somewhere. A lot of these ancient cultures, you know, like the Mayans as an example, were, you know, extolled because of their brilliance in the way that they monitored time. The Mayans had three different calendars. One of them, their long count calendar, was used for more or less predictions that would be happening more further out. And on one of these predictions, they had said, well, you know, our god, Kukulcan, is predicted to return. And on that day, unfortunately, Kukulcan did not return. The conquistadors showed up, aggressively converted all the Mayans to Christianity, and burned all their codices except for four. So it's not that the knowledge is always accurate, but it's always been used as a reference for knowledge of cyclical events. It's just that some of these scales of time are very hard for us to comprehend.
We're going to be headed towards a break, and as we do that, I'm going to lead. This is what we're going to do right after the break. I have if you were going to ask me, Jason, who built the pyramids, if it wasn't the Egyptians, at least in that dynastic period at 2500 BC, then who did it? If you ask me that question, I have a very specific answer. I'm going to deal with that right after the break. But then we have to go back and look at Pumapunku, which I think is one of the most significant sites on planet Earth, and it still freaks me out. I cannot comprehend that it even exists, and I wish it was bigger. But it's there. So I want to address these very specifically, and then we'll do some Gobekli Tepe, and we'll jump to Mars. Our guest tonight.
Sounds good.
Yeah, exactly. We're going to have some fun. Our guest tonight, Jason Martell. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. This is Fade to Black, bespoke radio for the masses on the Game Changer Network and KGRA The Planet. Follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. Jason's website, xfacts.com. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. More with Jason Martell right after this short break. Stay with us.
This is Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
The station that talks the net, KGRA Radio.
Hello, I'm Cassidy, and you're listening to my main man, Jimmy Church, on jimmychurchradio.com.
Hi, this is Ray Sobbs here, repping the planet, and you're listening to my good friend, Jimmy Church, Fade to Black, on the Game Changer Network and the KGRA Digital Broadcast Station.
What would your life be like if you woke up each morning with new vitality, feeling better than you have in years, and you noticed a difference in your sleeping patterns, blood sugar levels, and had a sense of well-being overall? There's something that is changing thousands of people's lives, and you could be one of them. It's called Heart and Body Extract. Sharon Harris, co-creator of Heart and Body Extract, talks about the positive effects of this product.
What happens with the formula Heart and Body Extract is it's giving the body the necessary vitamins, minerals, amino acids, enzymes, and phytonutrients so the body will heal itself. And yes, the body does have the ability to balance blood pressure, balance cholesterol, clean and unclog the arteries. It can also work on balancing the circulation for diabetics. So the body is an amazing thing. It simply needs some help so it has the tools to heal itself.
To order your 2 month supply, call now toll free 866-295-5305. Order online at hbextract.com.
Imagine no longer being tied down to your computer, but having the freedom to take live talk radio with you anywhere you go. TalkStream Live introduces our first ever iPhone application. The talk shows you follow now follow you, and your iPhone is now the fastest and easiest way to stay connected to the best talk radio on the internet. Let TalkStream Live transform the way you listen to radio. Listen to live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Mobile talk radio from TalkStream Live. Now available in the iTunes App Store.
This is Toby Kebbell. You're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Don't hurt me, Jimmy. I'm only little.
Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And this is Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers. The Honey Brothers. Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And I'm Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers.
And you're listening to Jimmy Church.
The Revolution.
What's up, Fader Knots? Studio Dumb loves Fade to Black and the F2B audience so much that they have put together the ultimate stereo Bluetooth system. They've done it just for you. Man, check this out. The Studio Dome SBB2 stereo system is here. It's featuring two Studio Boombox 2 SBB2 wireless Bluetooth speakers packed in its own custom hard shell case. This Studio Dome system features the very latest in stereo Bluetooth technology. The two full-range boomboxes are in true wireless stereo. You've got to hear this. It's amazing. It's just $129, and use the promo code JCRTWS, and you'll also get free shipping. It's simple. Just go to JimmyChurchRadio.com, click on the Studio Dome banner. Gobekli Tepe.
This is Micah Hanks of the Graylian Report, and you're listening to Jimmy Church on Fade to Black. Across the globe on the Game Changer Radio Network and the one and only KGRA Radio, the planet.
Welcome back, Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Tonight, Jason Martell is with us, Ancient Aliens. Tomorrow night, John Rappaport is here with his imagination presentation. Wednesday night, Dr. Louis Turi. Thursday night is Open Lines. Okay, so Jason, before the break, I gave you a few seconds to think about this. Who built the Great Pyramids?
You know, probably some lost ancient race that was probably connected to one of the first pharaohs in Egypt, like Akhenaten.
Your headset. Did we go back to?
Can you hear me now?
I got your laptop microphone.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. I
got the room sound. reset it. Just plug it in and unplug it and plug it back in.
All right. Sorry about that.
No, it's okay. Yeah, man. It's kind of funny. Well,
that's a shot. Give me 1 second.
Okay. I'll say this while we're waiting for that to reset is what I had said to Jason before the break was if Jason asked me who built the pyramids, my answer is very direct. I can tell you how they didn't do it. They didn't do it with copper chisels and stone hammers and sleds. That's
not how it happened.
How's that, Jimmy?
There you go. You're back.
Great. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
Yeah. So go ahead and restate that question, and I'll make
you know
sure.
Who built the pyramids. And my answer is, you know, oh, I can tell you how they didn't do it, and that's with copper chisels and stone hammers. That's not how it happened.
No, I don't think it was. And not only is that not the case with the tools used, but also the knowledge to place these structures. The main Giza pyramid is almost, I believe, less than one degree off of true north. I mean, that's just almost impossible to build something that accurate.
Yeah, my house, you know, no matter what, with the technology today, I believe, you know, lasers and those kind of pointing devices for construction, we're talking about the mid-60s into the 70s. And with all of the technology today to do that, to build a house in a subdivision, a true north, dude, who would do it and who cares? That's how important that structure was. That wasn't an accident.
Well, really the question you asked here that's the mystery is in two parts. One, who built the pyramids? And two, how old are they really? So, you know, you mentioned other sites, you know, right before the break there, like Pumapunku. And Pumapunku fits the same profile as Giza in a couple of scenarios. One, you have these massive megalithic stones that are fashioned in such a way that they're literally almost look like they've been cut with a laser. Now, I say that because the degree of angles and intricacy and cuts that we see across the Pumapunku stones, there's no way that they'd been able to do this by hand. It's just impossible. What we do see is evidence of some type of very high heat source, either like a laser or something. And the reason why I say that is because across a lot of these cut points, we see evidence of vitrification. And as you know, that's just a simple term that means it's like a glassing effect. The best way to explain it is if you took any type of stone, even granite or diorite, but then heat it up to the point where it's almost like in a magma-like state, well, then it becomes very pliable. It's almost like silly putty. And you could easily take maybe, let's say, a pre-cut out form, like a mold, and fill it with this magma-like rock, and then they harden into these stones that you see. So somehow, they had the ability, not only at Giza, but also at Pumapunku, to make these Lego-like blocks perfectly cut. The other thing, Jimmy, is the placement of Pumapunku. Pumapunku literally seems to be the remains of some great wharf. It probably was right on the shores of Lake Titicaca. At some time ago, the waters probably lapped up right onto the shores of Tiwanaku as well as Pumapunku. So if you look now, once again, on Google Maps at Lake Titicaca, you'll see that where Pumapunku and some of these sites are, there's a massive amount of meandering of the waters. You know, the waters have dehydrated to such a degree that we're talking about thousands of years. And so that's literally another evidence of trying to accurately date these sites.
When the erosion for the shores at Titicaca, what kind of time period are we looking at now when you backdate when Titicaca was as big as it should have been to not only lap at Pumapunku, but all of those sites that are right there? Pumapunku isn't the only one. What are we looking at? Is it?
I'd guess 10,000 years.
Yeah, I mean,
it's a huge, huge difference.
That's insane to me. Is there any evidence around Pumapunku that is new of some type of, I would almost say like a blacksmith shop, you know, where they were heating up these rocks? Is there any evidence around there at all of where and how it was manufactured?
Pumapunku is a difficult site because not only the builders, you know, astonished us with their technology, but they destroyed the site before they left. And if you ask any of the locals, they tell you that Pumapunku was built by the gods and destroyed by the gods. So we don't really know much about Pumapunku's origins other than looking and analyzing the remains of these structures. And so, yes, it's definitely something of an anomaly. And, you know, the best things that we can do to date a lot of these sites are, again, some of this geological evidence, but also the astronomical evidence and seeing when these alignments truly take place.
When the Spanish got there, help me out on this. When the Spanish got there, and they did, and this is documented, the Spanish literally said, okay, what is that over there and who built that? And that was their answer was, well, it wasn't us. It was the gods.
Pretty much. I mean, there's several of these sites, Jimmy, that we have around the area of Lake Titicaca, Cusco, Machu Picchu, even a little higher up, where we see a similar type of building style. And we really can't explain exactly who built these structures or why they were abandoned.
Yeah, I'm fascinated with that. With Machu Picchu and Cusco is another great example of this. Is okay. We can look at the rocks and we could try to figure out how they got that done. But the other part for me is the logistics. How did they get the rocks there? You know, Machu Picchu. You look at that and you just have to ask yourself. I'm going to do my best Childress. You have to ask yourself, right?
Yeah.
You have
to. How
is
this possible?
Is this possible?
I mean, you know, I don't know. I wish I knew the answer to that. I can give you some theories based on other sites like we see in Baalbek in Lebanon. We know that the quarry site for the rocks that we see stacked in Baalbek were about 5 miles away because – there's literally a site where one of the rocks that they were trying to pull out of the ground cracked off about two-thirds the way up. And it's literally, you know, it's probably weighs at least over 1,000 tons. It's 72 feet long. It's literally nicknamed the monolith. But it's a famous quarry site where somehow we know that this is where they were quarrying the rocks. And they carry these things somehow at least 5 miles to where they're now stacked in Baalbek. So there's no way that without some type of assisted technological device that they were able to move these things. And the best evidence that we've seemed to have heard of, I mean, no physical evidence as of yet, is maybe some type of levitation, either through sound or possibly some type of a resonance frequency that is able to, you know, modify or create a barrier where you can literally put something on like a barrier of sound. And now it's kind of like light as air and just kind of moves as if you touched it. Very hard to comprehend.
I read something about a month ago. I'm going to throw this past you where an archaeologist was commenting on Baalbek and said that those rocks, those formations were natural. Now, I ask you, again, my best Childress, right? I ask you, how is this possible? I mean, when you look at Baalbek, is there any, I mean, did that natural formation thought ever enter your head?
No.
You don't have to laugh.
If the ground is able to somehow spit out perfect rectangular cubes to be used as building platforms to launch and land what we hear some of these great kings like King Gilgamesh explaining that Baalbek is where he saw the gods descend and also ascend in loud flames and smoke and fire in their spaceships, or what they called, you know, shems or various other terms that clearly is describing like the gods in some type of a vehicle, like a conveyance of flight.
Now, okay, so I'm not going to put words in your mouth, but So it wasn't the Egyptians that built the pyramids. They just inherited them?
No, I'm not necessarily saying that the Egyptians built them or not, but I'm saying that if we look at some of the earliest dynastic pharaohs like Akhenaten, who was the famous the father of the famous pharaoh King Tut, King Tutankhamun. So his father was one of the first pharaohs of Egypt, Akhenaten, and he seems to be holding on to an older time frame, more when we were in the golden age. And it's very possible that this race of pharaohs was not completely human.
And so then, okay, let's stay on this then. So the linear calendar of the dynastic kingdoms is not what we think that it is, that it extends much, much further back.
Well, we could take this into another – interview. I know we've talked about it before, but as you know, I've been researching, looking at the Exodus that we have in the traditional Judaic, views of the Bible, and understanding that, you know, that Moses took his people out of Egypt. There seems to be a similar story of a Pharaoh Akhenaten also exiting Egypt with his people, but he also has a connected piece of technology that he seemed to have, seemed to have taken with him, which is the infamous Ark of the Covenant. And there seems to be a lot of evidence pointing to the fact that the Ark of the Covenant actually, originated in Egypt, was powering the Great Pyramid literally as a battery of some sort. And so when Akhenaten left with his people, he also took this Ark of the Covenant with him. So this time frame is a discrepancy between the story with Moses as well. And so there's a lot of these types of overlaps in information.
Is that so? What about Nefertiti?
Well, that's probably a whole other story that I would need to look into.
Well, because both missing, and so is the Ark, right?
Yes, and to this day, we still don't know the true location of where the Ark's origin is or where it's been resting.
So we find Akhenaten, or we find Nefertiti. Do we find the Ark?
Well, when you say Nefertiti, it's interesting because, you know, they have been doing excavations in Egypt, and just recently they did actually find, the mother of King Tut, or the wife of Akhenaten. They found, I believe, her grave or something similar to that effect. And these are digs that are going on in Egypt right now. So the gentleman, Dr. Zahi Hawass, who was kind of the director of antiquities there for about 20 years, he still has his finger on the pulse. I did an interview with him a couple months ago, and he was just explaining how, you know, sites like looking for Nefertiti and some of these really ancient first dynastic pharaohs and some of those people are still being searched for, and some of them will be found.
Well, it's what I'm thinking. This is just me, but that chamber that allegedly they have now confirmed that exists behind King Tut's burial chamber, that wall is there, and they have found evidence of
metal
and organic material, right? And now they don't want to go beyond that wall. My thing is, dude, if you find that, drill a hole, pop a camera in there, and let's find out. Like Gaten Brink's door, right? That's all you got to do. What's the harm in a little half-inch hole in the wall? If it turns out to be nothing, fill it up with silly putty, like you said earlier, right? Paint over it. Nobody's going to know. But it could be the greatest find since Howard Carter, and you're just going to let this go. I don't understand why they are always so reticent to find out something. It's like they don't want us to know, Jason. I'm serious.
Well, they've got their own interpretation, the Egyptologists. Dr. Zahi Hawass is very dead set in following the Egyptian view of their viewpoint. What's interesting, though, is that, from an outside perspective, we can look at a lot of these artifacts where they don't pay any attention to them, but we can. So sites like Dendera, and there's a wealth of these that just have so much information, but just singling out one, Dendera has two pretty interesting pieces of information. One, there's a wall relief that clearly shows Egyptians holding up what appears to be a light bulb, literally plugged into some type of like a power transistor. Now, you would maybe take note of this as not being an actual light bulb, but when we realize that a lot of the tombs and crypts all over Egypt have no evidence of soot or carbon on the ceilings, no evidence of flame. And so we really don't have any explanation as to how they were able to carve these wall reliefs or hieroglyphics. So what we see in Dendera, and literally that's Dendera is known as the place of the light-giving source. So, I mean, to me, when we look at, and you can just Google Dendera bulb, these wall reliefs are a clear depiction of them using a low-power electricity source for light, to power a light bulb. And so we see a lot of these that, to them, right, to the Egyptologists, they're like, well, don't look here, it's nothing. Another part of Dendera is on the ceiling, there's this huge like picture pulled back of our solar system that shows not only the 12 constellations we know of now, but even a much larger set of data. But what's really confounding, you know, or dumbfounding even, is, you know, it's a view from around 8,000 BC of the sky. So how is it that they either knew somehow just by knowing the movements of the heavens where the stars would be, you know, 6,000 years before them, or this is knowledge that was given to them, or maybe it's just they're a much older culture than we've been told.
When I look at the Dendera Zodiac and I try to wrap my mind around exactly what I'm looking at here, the only thing that I can think of is how is this possible? And I know it sounds juvenile to make that comment, but this is really, really old. And for this to be so accurately represented, and it's there, and it's circular, and everything, all the constellations, it's just, how is this possible? And so I'm going to ask you, how is it possible that this even exists?
Well, Jimmy, my research is, you know, going along the lines of many others that have come to the same conclusion. There is a larger cycle of time. All the ancients were tracking this through the use of these megalithic monuments as observation points to track the heavens because, you know, we all have heard these terms like the Golden Age, the Dark Ages. There seems to be a larger cycle of time that they track through the movements of the heavens. The pieces of the puzzle, some of the huge pieces that we've been missing, are things like we're possibly not a solar system governed by just one sun. Now, this isn't standard knowledge yet, but most circles of influence in astronomical society will tell you that it's common knowledge that most external solar systems we film are binary. They have usually more than one sun. So it stands to reason that we too are not a single sun solar system, that we are binary. And we've known this for many, many years, that well beyond the Oort cloud, there's possibly some dormant failed sun, a dark star, that is a dormant part of our solar system that has influence over us that, you know, we still don't understand. The kicker of this is that all the latest research looking for a ninth planet or a 10th planet or the 12th planet, depending on Sitchin's view or modern view, all of this influence seems to point to the same idea that there's a larger astronomical pattern here, but somehow the ancients knew that already and we're just relearning, as you said earlier, right? Everything is taught to us. So we're just relearning a lot of this knowledge that shows us where the answers literally are in the stars for what will happen in our future and possibly getting a clear understanding for what's happened in the past.
I'm looking at the Dendera Zodiac right now. I've looked at it way too many times over the years, but you know, I'm looking at Scorpio. I'm going to go around. You know, I see a ram. I see a bull. I see Aries. I see Pisces. I see Libra. I see the scales, right? Everything is here and represented. But at the same time, this same zodiac is in the United Kingdom that was, you know, that's 1,400 years old, these zodiacs that are over there.
Yep.
Obviously, they weren't in Dendera looking at the ceiling taking notes, but yet they are the same. And when I look at the stars, Jason, you and I have talked about this once before, not on the air, but when I look at the stars, I don't see a scorpion. I don't see Taurus. I don't, but they did. And they weren't communicating with each other. How is it possible that these same zodiacs can be found that are thousands of years old on different continents? I mean, I don't understand it unless it came from someone else.
Yeah, that's it, Jimmy. And it's stuff like this where it's just, you know, these types of needles in the haystack need to be singled out. When we analyze the fact that, you know, the 12 houses of the zodiac that make up what we understand now of those constellations as symbols, as you mentioned, whether it be the scorpion or the scales or the lobster or what have you, the ram, or the fish. These are all symbols that across any continent are identified as astronomical symbols. And beyond that, we have different cultures that have grouped these into a larger system of knowledge. In the Vedic cultures, we have different yuga cycles. So there's the Kali Yuga, the Dwapara Yuga, the Treta Yuga, and then the Satya Yuga. So the most commonly version, the common known version of this is the Greek-Roman, right? Where there's the Iron Age, the Bronze Age, the Silver Age, and then a Golden Age. All of these different cultures, Jimmy, seem to have the same astronomical references for a cycle of time that's governed by the movements of the heavens. And so this is what seems to be controlling what appears to be a rise and fall of civilizations here on Earth. I honestly do believe and contract seeing how, if you go back to the time of the ancient Sumerians and the Egyptians, they have high architecture, high knowledge of astronomy. And then as you start to approach, you know, the BC AD crossover, we lose all of that. And we're essentially in like Game of Thrones. It's the Dark Ages and everything's physical. No one has any knowledge of this type of stuff. But we slowly come out of the Dark Ages and we have the Renaissance Age, Copernicus, Galileo. We start to realize, well, holy crap, we're not actually the sun's rotating around us. We're orbiting the sun. And we're just now, only 2,000 years from then, you know, of the BC AD crossover, are we still relearning a lot of the stuff that we're now seeing the ancients knew and scratching our heads trying to figure out how or why they knew this.
And certainly in the in this zodiac for Dendera, which is, you know, at least, you know, it's at least, if we traditionally date it, let's go with 4,000 years old, right? But there are globes here. So much for the flat Earth idea. And the zodiac itself is a globe too, as well.
Right. Well, you know, a lot of the information about like circular knowledge of the circle or the wheel is pretty funny, because they say a lot of these cultures that didn't have knowledge of the wheel. And then you find like circular tablets with writing on it. And you're like, huh, okay, there's something wrong here.
It's so interesting to me. Now, when we come back, we're going to shift our attention to Mars. And you are going to be at Contact in the Desert in less than 2 short weeks. Can you believe it?
Yeah, it's coming up fast.
And you're going to be doing a presentation on Mars. And we're going to talk about that right after the break. I'm pretty excited about it. How many presentations are you doing at Contact?
I believe I'm doing a couple, speaking on a panel and participating in a couple of events as well. So I'm going to be spread pretty thin over the event.
And let everybody know, he's going to be hanging with us Friday night, Fade to Black Live. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Tonight, Jason Martell. We're going to jump to Mars right after this short break. Stay with us.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church.
You're listening to Fade to Black.
Always on the edge of the hottest alternative talk, Jimmy Church with Fade to Black. KGRARadio.com.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson, el tiburón, y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Do you know what's in your body soap? Well, I didn't know the answer until about 5 years ago when I looked at the label of my soap and was shocked to see all the chemicals. For my entire life, I had been assaulting the largest organ of my body, my skin, and to think my children were using it too. Well, a lot has changed since then. Today, my family and I operate Stone City Farms, where we make and sell all natural goat milk soap using fresh goat milk from goats we raise on our farm. Our mission at Stone City Farm is to produce high quality, all natural goat milk soap for people who want a fresh, unrefined natural product. At Stone City Farms, we offer scented and unscented soaps and a signature line of gift sets customizable to your needs. To see what our customers are saying, go to StoneCityFarm.com. Use the code NATURAL for a 20% discount. That's StoneCityFarm.com, code NATURAL for 20% off your order. You never know what could be hiding in your soap.
Did you ever turn to your radio for your favorite talk show to find that it's been preempted for this?
In the air to deep right center. Back goes Lewis to the wall. And it's all here!
Or this?
And I'm ashamed of you, Hillary, for voting for it.
Do you have a favorite talk radio program that's not available in your city? Just go to TalkStreamLive.com for links to the best streaming talk radio shows. At TalkStream Live, you will find live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All your favorites are here. With such a large selection, you will also discover some new favorites. On the go and still want to listen? With a mobile smartphone, simply type TalkStream Live on your internet browser. Now you can take internet radio with you. You will also find hundreds of music, news, and sports streams. Best of all, the TalkStream Live directory is free and there's never a login required. Remember TalkStreamLive.com, the fastest route between you and your favorite talk radio show.
You are listening to Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Network.
Oi, oi, I'm Rhys Evans. You're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution is on radio. Ciao.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. Our guest tonight, Jason Martell. I am your host, Jimmy Church. Tonight, it is Ancient Aliens, Lost Civilizations. We're going to talk some Mars right now. Tomorrow night, John Rappaport is here. We're going to do his imagination presentation. And then Wednesday night, Dr. Lewis Turi will be with us. Now, Jason, I'm going to ask you just directly, man. Mm-hmm. Are we Martians? Are you a Martian?
No, I'm an Earthling.
You're an Earthling.
but I think there's definitely a connection with Mars that shows we branched out as human beings beyond just Earth.
What's the best evidence?
The best evidence that I can point to currently would be Cydonia on Mars.
And ask me the same question.
Are we the Martians?
Well, you can ask me that. Or what's the best evidence?
Oh, well, yeah, I'm sorry. What is the best evidence?
NASA. That's the best evidence. You know why? Because when I look at pictures on the surface of Mars, and it's not necessarily Cydonia, and it's not, looking at objects, well, this is, No, what I see, Jason, is stuff. You know, I don't know what it is. I can't explain it, but it just doesn't look natural to me. It just doesn't. It looks really old, and it just looks like stuff that is just really old that is on the surface of Mars, that until we get there and start kicking stuff around and bending over and picking up objects and looking at, until we can actually do that, we don't know. But it looks like stuff.
That's a fair assessment.
No, and I know it sounds kind of dumb in a way, but look, it just doesn't look. It doesn't look like when I walk around a desert or the beach and I'm looking at rocks. Well, rocks look like rocks. You know what I mean? And you.
Well, look at.
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm sorry. No, I mean I agree with you. I mean I think part of the problem is not so much a cover up as that there's a political backup. You know, we've got an engineer that's been working at NASA for 16 years developing some type of a tool that's going to be sent up on a future probe that's going to stick into the dirt and analyze the sample for amino acids or something. So what's happening, Jimmy, is we're sending up probes that are equipped with tools that the science experiments aren't going to, like, you know, scoop up the dirt and look for an insect or, you know, they're – they're using tools that are only allowing us to look for signs of life. Unfortunately, if we take a step back from what their instrumentation has and look at the imagery, yeah, I'd agree with you. There is, as you put it, stuff all over the place. Unfortunately, we just don't have the tools on location to get the job done. Now, if someone was there, you're 100% correct. It would take them probably 10 minutes to sift through one of these locations with their hand to be like, look, it's a shell.
Right. It's a cell phone.
Yeah, it's a cell phone. Well, I mean, we say that in jest, but let's look at some of this data for a second here, and you know, with a serious eyebrow. The face on Mars was first filmed in the 70s, you know, by the Viking orbiter, and they labeled it simply head as it came down on the live feed. And they're like, look it, you know, several hours later, we filmed the head, and it was gone. It's a trick of light and shadow. Well, that was just the wrong answer, and it really opened up a whole can of beans to the topic of Cydonia.
Right.
The face on Mars was found by independent researchers Greg Molinar and Vincent DiPietro going through archives, and they found several other frame grabs where the orbit of the satellite is at a different angle, the sun is at a different time of day, the sun is at a different angle, and so hence the shadow on the face was a different angle. And there have been tests done by very credible people with PhDs looking at this data on the face in Cydonia, and NASA has never come forth with any of this or anything to refute it at that level. And I'll give you a very specific example. There's a gentleman named Dr. Mark Carlotto who wrote a book called The Martian Enigmas. And what he did is he actually has algorithms, mathematical algorithms that Dr. Carlotto has written, where he can look at satellite telemetry, let's say, of Earth, let's say over Russia. So he runs his mathematical algorithm over this satellite telemetry of Russia, and it will pinpoint all the tanks and troops that are covered up by, let's say, tarps or you know, shrubs and such. So he's got a mathematical algorithm to point out artificial structures. When he runs the same algorithms on the Martian telemetry right over Cydonia, the face and pyramids all come out, all of them, to be at least 98% probability to be artificial. I mean, and so this is real data. And so NASA never put forth anything to refute. And to this day, I would agree with you. There are things or stuff, as you said, all over the surface. And I've chosen to focus on some of those, which we can discuss tonight as well.
Like what?
Well, specifically, there appear to be standing bodies of water and vegetation all over the surface of Mars. And this can be found in the Malin Space Science Systems archives, the Mars Global Surveyor, the Odyssey, and several of the satellites that we've been sending to Mars have been taking imagery that clearly look like what you would see on Google Maps for if you look at the Great Lakes. And I have in my presentation, I'll be showing at Contact in the Desert, standing bodies of water on the surface of Mars, areas where there's clear vegetation being shown literally from NASA archives. Now, why aren't they showing this? Why aren't they coming forth with it? Because NASA is not going to produce a hypothesis that they can't back up or put answers behind. And so there it is. We have a mounting pile of data where no one's really paying attention to it, so that at some point, probably in the very near future, they can say, well, look, we've been gathering this data all along. And there's now a clear track record to show that, yes, there's life on Mars.
And what do you think about NASA presenting this whole red planet and red image of not only the planet itself, but the sky. And now it appears they have blue sunsets, that sky is blue. Does that tell you that, they've been misleading us? Maybe not a direct lie, but they've been misleading us.
Hey, a little bit.
Hey, you know what? Let's go to the phones. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black.
Well, this is George Noory.
What's up, George?
Hey, Jason. George. Hey, Jimmy.
You got us again.
Yeah, you got us again. Say hi to Jason.
Hello there. Here he's always there.
Yeah.
He's the staple of the show.
Man, Jason, you attract what is this, man?
The high caliber people. I'm so honored. Hey, we're going to see George here in a couple of weeks celebrating his birthday, too, from what I
understand. Contact in the desert. We're going to have some time there. Yes,
contact in the desert. And you know what's crazy? Most people don't know this, Jason, but George is only 29 years old. And most people don't know that. And
he's four.
And he's,
yeah, whatever.
He's found the fountain of youth. He's not sharing it with anybody. And he's got his secret thing that he does. And I don't think it's really cool.
Ponce de Leon was the one who found it for me.
Well, you know
he
what?
He gave it to. I was on his ship when he discovered it.
Yeah, right, right.
Age is a state of mind, guys. Come on. So you know
absolutely.
What?
Yeah.
You know, we'll all be bouncing around still when we're 90, as long as we're supercharged with this type of fun information.
Yeah, Jason is 59, George. I don't know if you know this.
And I understand, Jimmy, you met Rita on ParanormalDate.com. Yeah. I'm so impressed.
Yeah, most people don't know. You know, everybody will be going to Paranormal Date if they knew that's what happened.
That's awesome.
So who's on? Hey, George, really quick. Thank you for calling in. Very cool. Nice surprise. Yeah. And you know what? And I'll tell everybody, right, this was not planned.
Unplanned. I was listening to you, so yeah. I thought I'd harass you.
George, who do you have on the show tonight?
I got Lisa Gibbons on for a little bit from, of course, Entertainment Tonight and Celebrity Apprentice. She's talking about one of her new works. And then later on, Sean Carroll joins us to talk about the cosmos.
That's what I'm awesome. Talking about. And that's what I'll be doing after the show tonight. And you know what's funny, George? This is what I do every night. After we wrap here and I get in the car and we're done, I go straight. I know nobody's going to believe, but I listen to Coast to Coast after this show, and it's just what I do, and I know most people don't, you know, they don't believe that. That's what I do. I can't get enough of what we do here, and that's what I do every single night. What I was going to say to you, George. Oh, and this is what George does, right? So I know that George is on the air. I'm going to throw George under the bus. I know George is on the air, and he's texting me during the show. Church, what's up? I'm like, dude, don't you got a show to do? And I'm listening to George. I'm literally listening to George and getting a text at the same time. And I'm like, how is that possible? George, what's the secret?
I have Tom text for me.
Oh! Hey, George, thank you so much.
Okay,
so,
kid.
We'll
see you later.
We'll see you in two short weeks.
Your voice, George.
Right. Bye-bye.
See you later. It's really Jason, what's up with that, man?
I don't know, but it's always so good to hear his voice. It's so iconic, right? Like, as soon as I hear George's voice, I feel like I'm listening to Coast to Coast. You know?
It's funny because it was over 2 years ago when he did it to you and I for the first time.
I know.
And so I was funny. Like, this ain't George. This ain't George.
It's all good.
It's all good. Now, back to Mars.
Yes.
What I'm feeling it in my bones. This is what I honestly feel is what would we do here now? And this is follow me. Just go with me on this. If this planet got 5 degrees hotter, right. Or, you know, things started to disintegrate here where we knew that we had to go somewhere else. You know what? We're going to Mars. We're terraforming. We're going to get the colony going, and everybody here on planet Earth is going to be saying, are we ready? Can we go? You know, we can't live here anymore. We go to Mars. That's what. So if there was a civilization on Mars and things broke down, where would we go? Well, we would go to Earth, wouldn't we? It's not because it's not that far of a stretch, because that's exactly what we would do. Am I wrong in thinking like that?
No, I think it makes sense, Jimmy. And, you know, we're just trying to piece together the evidence of, you know, what little information we're given through these public agencies. What's really going on Mars today? I mean, it's so much speculation. And a true ufologist of today has to factor in many sources of information and have a very fine-tuned BS meter. So for me, for instance, I look at Mars as a topic of not only trying to discover what's happened in the past through this very small lens of access they give us, but also trying to piece together the logical record when we hear things, let's for instance say that made-up movie Alternative 3 that shows Russians in color landing on the Mars surface in the 60s and then seeing something scurrying outside of their window, you know, and doing it in jest. But there's been all kinds of sources of information. You kind of have to put it in a big pot and stir it that tells us we've probably been on Mars for a very long time already.
And when you see all of those images popping up on the internet and you're looking at those images of Mars, what pops through your mind? Are you just saying, yeah, you know, whatever, I get it, I know that stuff is there? Or do you find yourself looking at them and just wondering, what if, you know, what goes through your mind?
Misdirection. I think that a lot of people are being shown and looking for things of, you know, a bolt or a head or some tire. And who cares, honestly, like what's really going on Mars and what's really up there? We're just simply not shown. We just don't have access. And so I think that's really the larger egg to crack. And I don't have the answer, Jimmy, other than time. You know, as we start to take the reins of the space agencies out of just being in the Department of Defense and National Security Agency, it's going to be a long battle. But NASA is dissolving. And even these new companies that we have now, like SpaceX and such, they all have a hand in the Department of Defense being essentially their governing body, and putting restrictions and things in place. So I don't know. I think very near future here, you know, the entrepreneurial ability to launch drones and small space packages is going to put so many different lenses out there, and even as far out as Mars, I'm sure, where we're going to start to be able to monitor and see things that I just don't know how they're going to cover it up or hide it. And I think that precipice is going to happen within our lifetime.
What's your gut on that? I mean, why either deflect or go down that disinfo road or blatantly lie? Why not just tell us, you know what, there's probably something there. We're going to go find out, and we're going to put a rover down on the right spot, and we're going to go dig, and we're going to get to the bottom of this. Why don't we hear that? I mean, why the big lie? Are they scared? Are they scared of our reaction, that we would freak out? And I just don't feel that.
Well, I don't know, Jimmy. My gut reaction tells me that there's just been a large cover-up in place for a long time. And that the established systems in place now are still the governing factor for how they handle this type of information. And so more than likely, you know, there are, through the right channels, people like us doing things in space now, possibly manning space bases on the moon and Mars. This is my true opinion.
Right.
But being able to prove that is a different thing. What I can do is simply point to the evidence that shows for a long time there's been reverse engineering systems and scenarios in place where we've been, you know, getting our hands on technology and advancing our own knowledge with this technology, that there has to be some type of a point where there's a crossover from this being all secretive and all super quiet to one day coming out of the box. Now, I don't think it's going to just be all at once. And so a lot of these things that we can look towards for in the past is saying, well, let's start to make our own track record of understanding how we got to where we are. Wow, there's still some really big gaps in trying to understand where we're truly at in this timeline of our reality today.
I started to ask you before George called in about the blue skies on Mars. What does that tell you? Do you think you and I, we cruise to Mars, right, tomorrow, and we get there. Do you think we could actually breathe? Do you think there's a breathable atmosphere there, and there was a reason to always show a red sky when we know now that that is not the case?
My gut tells me yes, that probably there's an atmosphere enough to sustain low levels of oxygen in certain areas that you could probably just breathe without any type of gear. The reason why we have those red skies, in my opinion, is that a lot of the times that we're sending these packages to Mars on an orbiter, a lander, what have you, when we're imaging from the surface, the cameras that they use are taking a larger spectrum of light than what the human eye can process. So a lot of times what NASA is simply showing is just the unfiltered view of this footage. When you color correct it through RGB of what the human eye would see, you instantly see blue skies on Mars. So whether or not it's intentional or not, it does seem to be in their favor of playing down the idea that Mars is, you know, habitable and hospitable by showing it with this, you know, red tint always, in the past.
Would you be surprised if there was something living underground on Mars, if you couldn't live on the surface?
No, and I think that's interesting that you bring that up, because a lot of the scenarios of where there could be large crevices, the Gusev crater and various other spots. Like, let me get very specific as an example. NASA has spent a lot of time and interest into a certain area called the Gusev crater. And what's interesting is that when we look at the NASA photography of the Gusev crater, we see these, in black and white, these streaky lines. It looks like, I don't know, oil coming out of the ground or some. It's very hard to decipher. Those same coordinates of the Gusev crater filmed by ESA, the European Space Agency, in color, shows not these streaky lines, but green patches.
Yep.
It's clearly vegetation. It almost as if to be that there could be something there now. Yes, alive.
I'm looking at some of those pictures right now, and I don't know if it's moss, if it's vegetation, if it's
algae,
and these are at a distance. It could be shamrocks for all we know, you know, like I'm being
right.
Serious. Yes,
that's right.
It's definitely green. I mean, I don't know, it could be a putting green, but it's definitely green, and I don't know why they're spending so much so much time there and shooting it, unless there's something there. And then this is the other thing, Jason. Why on God's green earth, no pun intended, aren't they putting instrumentation, rovers, equipment down where it matters? A, in the snow, B, in the ice, and C, where there looks like there's vegetation and flowing water. It's like we put these rovers down in areas where it doesn't matter, A, and B, where they can't really do anything. They drill for a half inch into a rock. You know, dig a hole 3 feet deep. Let's see what's down there. But they don't. I just don't understand it. When technically we can do whatever we want there.
I mean, maybe they are, Jimmy. They're just not fully sharing all that. Now, where you can catch them in kind of a stranglehold on the knowledge here is that, you know, recently we had this movie come out, Matt Damon, The Martian. Unfortunately, NASA comes out with this big press release. Wow, there's evidence of watery past on Mars just in time for the movie The Martian. Turns out that this is just recycled knowledge. Literally the same knowledge, the same site, Gusev Crater, all of these ancient flowing saltwater rivers, essentially, were announced in 2004. I'm literally looking at it on my screen right now in my PowerPoint. You know, it's called Mars 2004. They made this big, cool graphic. M2K4, roaming the red planet. Signs of a saltwatery sea. And this is in 2004 they released that. And they just kind of recycled it 12 years later. So they're sitting on this stuff. And they have been for a long time. The kicker, though, Jimmy, is that if you look through any of the archives, if you literally go onto Malin Space Science Systems and look through, spend an hour, just sip a bottle of wine, eat some cheese, look at some of these images, and you will be astounded that this is the surface of Mars, folks, not Earth.
Because
it looks like it's alive.
Right. And have you seen the footprint on the Gusev crater? Have you seen that image?
The footprint? No, I have not.
Okay, I'm tweeting this out. This is one of my favorite shots. Unfortunately, this is a Getty image, and Getty has got their
watermark.
Yeah, watermark right over it. But anyway, I don't care. I'm going to send this out right now. And it's an incredible image. Now, I don't know what it is, but I can tell you what it's not. It's not natural. And you can look at everything else that is around this image. Just take a look. There's nothing else like it. If it's natural, you would see repetitiveness. Man, I'm way too much coffee tonight. I keep getting tongue-tied. Way too much of that. But here in this image, it's a lone footprint sitting there all by itself. I just tweeted it out. Now, everybody, just look at that. What is that?
Jimmy, you know, there's been a lot of rumors and unsubstantiated information of frame grabs around the rover, as an example, the Pathfinder, where literally there appears to be, and every now and then, some circumstance where you literally see what could be like a technician stand behind the rover on Mars. You know, some yes. circumstance where there's literally just, it's like a joke, right? Like, we can see and pull these instances out and put them on a timeline and see that the amount of events add up. When the astronauts first landed on the moon, when they're cruising around on their little space buggy, right, made of like tin, literally the astronauts are quoted as saying, "Why do you send us here in a tricycle when the military is here in Ferraris?"
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
That matters, you know?
It does matter. And also, there's been a lot of images out there that I have seen that show different spots around planet Earth where there are rovers that have been shot where you can see the background and it matches the Marscape that is in shots. Now, I don't know if they are out testing the rovers, you know, somewhere remote on Earth, as they should. They're taking photographs and then they leak these photographs, make it out onto the internet, and they were shot here on Earth. But now they're using it as evidence that, you know, it was shot, that we are not on Mars, that these are all shot here.
Of course, of course. It's like the moon footage or the Billy Meyer photos. You add in one or two fakes, they're all fakes. No. No, that's not the case. There's definitely enough evidence to show that not only have we been on the moon, but that a lot of these, you know, photographs are in fact true. It's just, how do we get further evidence? And that's unfortunately the challenge, since NASA and most of these agencies are the ones that currently have the keys, if you will.
I wanted to jump back really quick before the break. I was at Jason's house, Rita and I, yesterday, and I walked in. Somebody just tweeted out the picture of you with the Dendera bulb, right, from TV. And I walked in yesterday with Rita, and there it was, you know, on the shelf in your living room. And I'm looking at it. That, when I look at that, Jason, honestly, I swear, what else can it be? But it's one thing to see it in the relief in Dendera, but it's another thing to see your replication of it on display in 3D where you can look at it. I mean,
you should have tapped me on the shoulder. I would have turned it on.
Man. You know, I was so distracted. And I wanted to get to the Baghdad battery yesterday. I don't know how I got out of your house without doing that too as well. But looking at what I saw yesterday, the 3D version of it, I mean, honestly, is there another explanation for it? It doesn't feel that way to me.
If you ask an Egyptologist, they'll tell you that the imprint on Dendera is of the lotus flower, and the bulbous mass with the snake in the middle coming out is the aroma of the lotus flower.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's my opinion on that.
Okay, yeah, that's my opinion too. Well said. This is Fade to Black. Now, when we come back, we're going to take some calls. Let's do that. And you know what? I'm going to break the rules tonight. I'll deal with this later. I'll give away one pass to Contact in the Desert, and we'll do that. 323-825-5045. Yeah, we're out of passes, but I'm going to give one away tonight. I'll make it happen. If you can go to Contact in the Desert, 323-825-5045. But make your question to Jason spot on. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. We'll be right back.
Hi, everybody. This is Rob Halford, the Metal God, on JimmyChurchRadio.com.
KGRA Radio.
Intelligent talk.
So, you love talk radio, then you'll love TalkStreamLive.com. TalkStream Live is always on, 24-7, with the best streaming talk shows. Find your favorite talkers and discover some new ones. It's free, readily available online or on any smartphone or tablet. Finding your favorite talk shows all in one place has gotten a whole lot easier. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com. Be sure to download the free apps from Google Play or the iTunes App Store.
If your home has hard water and it's leaving white spots, then it's likely that limescale is clogging your pipes. Limescale can cost hundreds of dollars a year in wasted energy and early appliance breakdown. HydroCare systems available at Wave Home Solutions prevent and remove limescale with just a simple filter change every 3 years. There are no salts, chemicals, or magnetic coils. Satisfaction guaranteed. For more information, just go to bestwater123.com. That's bestwater123.com.
Hi, I'm Richard Dolan. When I'm not hosting my radio program, The Richard Dolan Show on KGRA, or writing new books on UFOs, I run a publishing company. I'm proud to say that Richard Dolan Press has published some of the most fascinating books available on UFOs and related subjects. They include Dr. Bruce Maccabee's classic analysis of the UFO cover-up, David Marler's breakthrough book on triangular UFOs, Dr. Richard Sauter's unique work on underground bases, and other classics by Grant Cameron, Chase Kletsky, and Dr. Bob Wood. Not to mention intriguing works by Eve Lorgan and Laurie McDonald that deal with truly bizarre phenomena. I'm proud to publish such high-quality and original works, and there are several amazing books about to be released over the next few months. Go to richarddolanpress.com to learn more.
Did you know that when you're on the road with limited data or Wi-Fi available, you can still listen to every minute of Fade to Black by just calling 605-562-4482. No smartphone, app, or internet needed. It saves your data plan and no extra cost if you have unlimited minutes. Just call 605-562-4482. You can listen to me, Jimmy Church, on any phone, anytime, anywhere. Gobekli Tepe.
You want to know a secret? I love ponies. I really love ponies. I'm serious. I couldn't stay sane without ponies to brush.
Why fade to black? Because you never got that pony, damn it.
This is Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. Our guest tonight, Jason Martell. Taking your phone calls right now, 323-825-5045. Talking ancient aliens, lost civilizations. Right now we're talking about Mars and that footprint on Mars. Tomorrow night, John Rappaport's going to be here. We're going to do his imagination presentation. Wednesday night, Dr. Lewis Turi will be here. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Jason, I don't know if I've ever, while I'm waiting for the phone calls to come in, I don't know if I've ever asked you this. Have you ever seen something strange in the sky?
I had a slight UFO sighting that actually made me very interested in a lot of these topics.
What'd you see? When was it?
Yeah, I'd say, 20 years ago now. It was in Solana Beach when I was in college and saw something fly across my vision. So I had a 180 degree of view of the sky, and this thing was like a cloudy mass with lights in it, and it separated into individual cloudy masses with lights in it, and was constantly moving with no sound, and it freaked me out. The reason why it freaked me out is that there were so many other things that my eye would be able to identify, and this is something I could not. So yeah, it was a very compelling experience.
How big was it?
It was fairly large. I mean, it was definitely larger than like a plane.
Interesting. Any sound? How long did it last?
It lasted for about 15 seconds, 10 to 15 seconds.
Okay. And now that you've got 20 years of investigations behind you, what do you think you saw?
I think I saw something that was probably not from this world or was some type of classified project that was very, very impressive.
Interesting. Let's go to the phones. Hi, you're live on Fade to Black. Say hi to Jason Martell.
Hey, Jimmy and Jason. This is Ward from Fort Myers.
Hey, Ward. How are you, man?
How's it going?
All right. All right. Hey, Jason, I've got a question. You know, I've watched all the Ancient Aliens episodes and all these programs, but I remember when I was little, like about 71, 72, I think there was a book called In Search of Ancient Mysteries or something similar to that. And they've had two things in there that I've never seen you guys bring up. One of them was a pillar, I think it was in India, that never rusts, that's made of iron. Do you ever hear of that?
That does sound familiar.
Yeah, I've heard that too, yes.
And then there's another one that I'd like to see more about, is that there's this stone that these guys were all standing around, and supposedly that if 10 guys touch the stone, it levitates.
Okay, that you got me on.
Do you know where it's located?
No, I don't know. That's what I'm saying. It was in one of those books from 71, 72. I used to get all those books. And I was just surprised I haven't heard about either of those things. And those things always stuck in my mind, you know, because that was pretty cool. If they have the, maybe that's the technology they use to, you know, build this stuff. Maybe,
right.
You know.
To lift the stones. Yeah.
Right, right.
Well, okay, on the next episode of Ancient Aliens featuring.
Thank you for the call. Good information.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, yep.
Thank you, okay. Ward. Yeah, great phone call.
Yep. Thank
you, Ward. I remember hearing about that metal pillar in India that doesn't rust, and somebody's going to tweet that out here in just a second. When we talk about stuff like that, Jason, and Ward brings up a really good point. We do have the megalithic structures. Yes, I get that. And they're stones, and they're built to last forever, and that's why they're still here. And it's some of the greatest stuff that we have. But putting that aside, and like the Baghdad Battery, the other stuff that isn't stone, what do you think is the best evidence of a high technology from a lost civilization that would predate, you know, modern history? And I'm referring directly to Mesopotamia or Sumer and going beyond that. What's the best evidence of it?
Well, the best evidence, Jimmy, I mean, I guess from more of a pulled back perspective is just looking globally at all of these sites that seem to have this type of tampering, that clearly the people on the ground were going to great lengths to communicate to people in the skies.
Okay, I have it here. Ah, interesting. Okay, I got it. It is called the Iron Pillar of Delhi. And yes, it is rust resistant, and there it is. It's one of the Gupta monarchs, and it comes from 402, the year 402 AD. And it's been at its current location since 1233 CE. Interesting. There it is. And it is, looks brand new. It doesn't rust. Wow.
You know, the other thing to consider, Jimmy, too, is that we have sites all around the world too, that are not even above ground. Sites in like Okinawa, Japan, Dwarka, India. We have places that are literally underwater cities that we know were above ground at one time, but we're talking about a date that's, again, at least 10 to 15,000 years ago.
Specifically, when we talk about Japan, when I see Yumaguni, when I see it, it looks 100% man-made. There's no, in fact, I'll go beyond that. I'll say 105%. But Shock has poo-pooed on that completely, saying, you know what? No, That is natural. Why is it that he can see one thing and I can see another? Because it's an obvious man-made structure.
Well, whether the Yonaguni structures are man-made or not, the terracing that we see there, other sites like the Bimini Road,
yes,
places like Dwarka in India, where we clearly know that it's talked about, not only in their Mahabharata and other texts, but there's physical evidence. There's enough of these sites around the world to show that, yeah, there are other civilizations that existed, and that the water levels were at different heights. We're talking hundreds of feet in height difference. So that's some serious topography changes that, again, thousands of years must have, you know, that we're talking about here.
It's where else in nature does something like 90 degree angles repeat? Am I, you know what I mean? We're not talking about spirals, and we're not talking about organic situations. We're talking about structures, stair steps, doorways, entrances, rooms that you see represented there, that it just doesn't repeat in nature in that form.
You know, and the other thing, Jimmy, too, is we always come back to this question, like, well, who have built this, or who could have influenced the people to give them this knowledge? And the only answer that I can point to so far is that we seem to see a lot of these sites and locations, these long, slender beings being depicted. Sites like Indonesia and Bata Valley, or even if we go to remote areas like the islands of the Moai heads, Rapa Nui. So we have these heads that appear to be just sticking out of the ground, but they've actually excavated them and shown that they're actually long, slender bodies. And so various sites, even Gobekli Tepe on some of these pillars, you again see these long, slender figures. And I wonder if this isn't some type of a reference to these beings, to this actual lost race that either influenced or existed in the building of a lot of these sites.
When you look at Gobekli Tepe, and you know they play a drinking game, the audience. So every time we say Gobekli Tepe, somebody is taking a drink.
Gobekli Tepe, Gobekli Tepe, Gobekli.
And going back to Gobekli Tepe, the one thing that trips me out the most, where I just think that the dogma of archaeology and mainstream academia, where they are just completely wrong and they're still in denial, is that friggin' belt buckle right on the T-pillar. And when you see that, when you see a belt buckle and a belt, which is obviously part of the clothing, which suggests fashion sense that, I'm sorry, Stone Age man didn't have. And you see that is evidence of knowledge.
Yeah,
that wasn't that wasn't supposed to exist. So then we see it there, and it's there, and it's, and the carbon dating and the age of the site is not in dispute now. It's been aged, and we have that. But we have a belt buckle on Stone Age man. Now, Stone Age man carved that belt buckle in a 3D relief. He did it for a reason, right? That is high technology, high fashion, a fashion sense. There are designs on the belt itself. And how can they stop and just insist that, well, you're not giving enough credit, you know, it is what it is. They can't do that anymore. Why do they insist on being in denial?
You know, a lot of these depictions are interesting. You bring that up of the Gobekli Tepe. I understand what you're seeing there. I was actually looking at the images you were talking about it, the belt buckle, the belt that wraps around. Other artifacts, too, out of Sumer, we have the depictions of the Anunnaki. And a lot of times these beings, the Anunnaki, the word Anunnaki simply means those who from heaven come to earth. But these Sumerian gods, these Anunnaki, are a lot of times depicted with wearing, you know, a certain attire. A lot of them have bird-like characteristics, sort of like a headdress and such. And a lot of times, if you look even closer, you'll notice them wearing what appears to be a wristwatch. Now, it looks like it could also maybe just be a bracelet with a flower, but it's very symbolically placed and has all of the attributes visually of a modern day wristwatch.
And before we do that leap of faith, let me ask you, what is it that you think you are seeing? Is it a wristwatch? Is it high technology, or is it decoration?
I think what we're seeing is the ancient man doing their best to depict what they saw without fully understanding the true purpose or meaning of what they were recreating. And I say that simply because we already have a term for it, which is called cargo cult. All throughout World War I, World War II, we see Aboriginal tribes being visited by U.S. soldiers for the first time, landing in prop planes.
Right.
They set up camp, right? You know, they jump out of a plane and light up a cigarette and hold out a voice recorder and capture sounds and voices from the Aboriginals and play it back. The Aboriginals are looking at them. And they're like, how did you light that fire instantly? That thing you climbed out of, this living flying thing, what is it? And now all of a sudden, you know, the soldiers are getting drop ship supplies, and sometimes these shipments would land in the middle of the tribe instead of the camp, and the tribesmen crack it open, and it's, you know, canned food and guns and stuff. And they're like, oh, these living flying things are sending us gifts. And then all of a sudden the soldiers leave. The camps pack up and they leave. And an interesting phenomenon takes place. We see them, the Aboriginals, carving away the runways, essentially scraping away and keeping the runways clean that the planes were landing on, and then creating straw models, life-size models of a prop plane. They don't even understand how it works, but they sit there for hours staring at the sky, hoping to entice them back.
You would do the same thing if you tasted chocolate, right?
Well,
and then you get cut off.
Some other analogies of things that could be dropped down by space people that I got a taste of, and I'd be like, wow, bring it back.
Exactly.
Whoever, who knows what bucket you want to put that in, but I'm sure there are exotic things that could be equated to the same experiences that some of the people seem to have experienced from beings that at one point were either super advanced or, in many cases, yes, were probably not from Earth.
Well, and you bring up a great point, which is when you look at some of these cave paintings and cave art, some of it 25, 30,000 years old or older, and you look at these cave paintings with obvious helmets on these beings, antennae, spacesuits, and you see this stuff, when somebody tells me, well, you know what, they didn't really know what they were looking at. Or they didn't understand, or they were dreaming, I have to stop them dead in their tracks and say, look, that was a lot of effort for somebody to do 30,000 years ago. That is a lot. They could be out getting food and surviving, but instead they were spending all of their time and energy and resources to recreate this on the wall because it was important to them. And what they were looking at wasn't other human beings wearing helmets, because they didn't have those back then. They saw something and they wanted to make sure that they depicted it exactly like they saw it, like that wristwatch. Yes. And so what was it that they were seeing 30,000 years ago that had a helmet on, unless it was somebody with a helmet on?
Right. And that's just the thing, Jimmy, is that across the globe, you know, we have these artifacts now from the ancient alien or ancient astronaut hypothesis, however you want to slant it, which simply shows that there's pieces of technology that man was depicting that now from our standpoint, well, you know, we look at it and we're like, well, look, it's clear that even though the Egyptian museum will put those on display and call them insect models or bird models, we can look at them now and say, well, look at what you're calling an insect. To me, that has all the intrinsic characteristics of a modern-day prop plane, right? Or it looks like something that could be actually flown rather than something that's, you know, born in nature. So a lot of the things that we can see that they were depicting to us without fully understanding how it worked, we can see that they were clearly depicting evidence of high technology.
What about the what about this? The evidence of an advance. I'll just say like Atlantis, right? Or Lemuria, an ancient civilization that was here for a long time that spread out 100,000 years ago. You know, Lloyd Pye brings up a really good example of this, where he was saying that we were reseeded, you know, after each cataclysm, and then we just started over and we reseeded the planet and we started over again. That 5 million years ago or 10 million years ago, we came and went. We came and went, done. And then a few lone survivors reseeded the human population around the world. What do you think about that and the way that Lloyd Pye kind of presented that?
Thank you for bringing up Lloyd's name. I miss him dearly.
I miss him dearly every day.
He was a good friend and aspired researcher on many levels for me. And I always, man, watching him give his presentation on the Darwinistic viewpoints and how there's just these huge gaps in that evolutionary timeline.
It just pissed you off, didn't it? It's just, he was so right. You know what I mean?
Well, that's why his book was called Everything You Know Is Wrong. You know? you bring up a good point there, though. You know what I mean? A lot of that evidence is something that it's just really hard for us to substantiate, you know, without having some type of actual alien DNA or something along those lines. Lloyd was always really good at looking at that lineage and pointing out the differences between us and them. So, you know, whether there's a receding, excuse me, Jimmy, after each cataclysm, what worries me is that there does seem to be an overlap between when we're at our highest states in this cycle of time, let's say when we're in our golden age, that doesn't mean that it precludes us from being also subjected to some type of cataclysm.
And if we restarted, I read something today that, and I found it fascinating. I was going to use it for my favorite, that I didn't know that the male and female brains, I know this is going to sound stupid, are identical. I did not know that. I thought that there was going to be some kind of difference between our two brains. But apparently, they are absolutely dead nuts identical. And if we restarted, you know, and the brains were the same, and the brains were always the same, that we had to somehow get that knowledge restarted too. Or was that knowledge always there in our DNA, like Lloyd Pye presents to us, that that knowledge was always going to come out of us on a set calendar and timetable?
Well, we've all seen the movie Limitless and these various other things where, you know, they speed that timetable up and unlock our DNA. I mean, what I find interesting is that there's enough evidence, Jimmy, right, to look at what's going on here. Somehow the human brain has been partitioned and we only use, you know, at best 10% of our brain. Every other species on the planet, folks, like the cockroach you step on, they're using their full neural network. Why are we limited to only 10%? Something has happened. So, yes, that genetic partition was definitely put in place. One can only guess why or by who. And so that's why I very much so latched on to the Anunnaki story through the Sumerian knowledge, is because they seem to have an answer at least to why and who put that genetic partition in place.
Now, Pye talks about this a lot, but there's one thing where I get a little bit confused on, and it's this. If us, you and I, Homo sapiens sapien, us today, us, is 150,000 years old, which is easy enough to understand and figure out, but the Anunnaki are on a completely different timetable and things are thrown back 250, 300, 400,000 years. How do we explain that gap and that part of it?
I'm not sure I quite understand your question, but I can answer it by saying, you know, if we look at the mitochondrial DNA that they found in Southern Africa that pretty much matches us of the modern man, we know that mitochondrial DNA seems to be inherently passed down from females and doesn't genetically change or mutate. So the mitochondrial DNA that looks like us pretty much shows up in southern Africa 300,000 years ago, which seems to be in alignment for the Sumerian epics of creation and explaining when the Anunnaki first splashed down here with 50 people, 50 Anunnaki, if you will, and then started doing this whole mining thing and realized the toil that it would take, and then henceforth began this whole genetic experiment creating the Adam and the Eve and the things that we know of today and creating, you know, the human race. So.
And my question was the Anunnaki timeline. Help me understand it. That's all, because I'm not the expert here. You are. The Anunnaki timeline, that when they descended here, are we looking at
300,000 years ago?
Yeah, 300,000 years ago. And you and I, modern humans, are at 150,000 years ago. And the cloning that they did to create us for the mining, which is well documented, when did that occur? Did that occur 150,000 years ago when we showed up, or did that occur at 300,000 years ago?
It occurred at 300,000 years ago, and they had a few different experiments of versions, Lulu-Amelu, primitive workers, until they finally had a version called the Adam. In Hebrew, it's called Adamu, the worker. But they called it the Adam, and there's actually a cylinder seal where one of their chief scientists, an Anunnaki named Ninhursag, is holding up the Adam, and she says, my hands have made it, the perfect working model. And so this was a model that was able to actually procreate. So there were versions before that that did not procreate. So they were messing around with us, I'm sure, for probably at least 100,000 years, tinkering and tuning and stuff until they found a version that was probably aesthetically as well as dumbed down enough for them to do what they needed to do with us.
Yeah, because Pi points. Ooh. Are you there? Oh, I just lost Jason. Just like that, Jason. Oh, man, I can't end the show like this. I'll wait for Jason to come back. That was bizarre. I'm going to make this point before I head to break, is the point that Lloyd Pye had always made.
Sorry, I'm back.
Okay, there you go.
I moved away and the mic unplugged from
the sorry. The one point that Lloyd made was that there's to make that leap in the evolutionary chain would take millions of years. There's no way that we go from one forehead to the next. I'm paraphrasing here, of course. And the physique and the jawline, the bone structure, the bone thickness, the skin, and everything else that we made, that would take millions of years. And apparently we literally made it overnight. And that wasn't an accident. And there's only one thing that could do that, and that is somebody going in with knowledge of DNA and how to mess with it. And that's how it was done. And there's no real, there isn't another real explanation for that. And science is just going to say, hey, well, it just happened, you know.
Well, they're still rediscovering it now. The whole junk DNA and, you know, decoding our genome and such, everything is going to point to the fact that there's intelligence in the engineering of our design.
Thank you so much, Jason. You are the absolute best, my brother. So
thank you, Jim.
And we're going to see you in 2 short weeks, and I look forward to it. Give my best to Taylor. Thank you so much. Website and the best way to get a hold of you is X-Facts and
just jasonmartell.com is the best way. And like you said, Contact in the Desert is the next appearance. I'm very much looking forward to the event and also reconvening with fans.
Thank you so much, Jason. Have a great, safe rest of your evening, my brother.
You too, Jimmy. Take care. Bye-bye.
You got it. Jason Martell, everybody. Let's head to a break. And when I come back, your phone calls, 323-825-5045. I'm going to apologize right now for not picking up because, you know what? We were in a conversation. But I'll still give away that pass. 323-825-5045. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church, on the Game Changer Network and KGRA The Planet. I'll be right back. We'll be right back.
listen to my boy, Jimmy Church, on jimmychurchradio.com.
Despite popular opinion, reading a book will not make you smarter.
But listening to Jimmy Church will.
Hey, I'll make you a deal. Give me 60 seconds and I'll give you directions to the Fountain of Youth. Okay, I'm joking. Well, kind of joking. No fountains, but youth, I got. Nature's Youth and their premier anti-aging product, Nature's Youth RSF. With your sensible diet and exercise plan, Nature's Youth RSF can help you look and feel better. RSF is an all-natural amino acid supplement that supports your body to naturally increase HGH levels without any synthetic hormones. And elevated HGH levels can contribute to increased energy, improved libido, reduced body fat, and improved exercise capacity. Let's be honest, who doesn't want to look and feel younger? Visit the newly designed website at naturesyouth.com or call 800-333-6923. That's 800-333-6923 and like them on Facebook and you'll be included in contests and exclusive offers. What a deal. Oh, speaking of deals, my time's about up. 800-333-6923 or naturesyouth.com. Who needs a fountain anyway? Call today.
What's up, Fader Knots? Studio Dumb loves Fade to Black and the F2B audience so much that they have put together the ultimate stereo Bluetooth system. They've done it just for you. Man, check this out. The Studio Dumb SBB2 stereo system is here. It's featuring two Studio Boombox 2 SBB2 wireless Bluetooth speakers packed in its own custom hard shell case. This Studio Dome system features the very latest in stereo Bluetooth technology. The two full-range boomboxes are in true wireless stereo. You've got to hear this. It's amazing. It's just $129, and use the promo code JCRTWS, and you'll also get free shipping. It's simple. Just go to jimmychurchradio.com, click on the Studio Dome banner, Gobekli Tepe.
It's not a lifestyle we chose. We were born this way. KGRARadio.com.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com.
All right, welcome back, Fade to Black. I'm your oh so humble host, Jimmy Church. 323-825-5045. If you can make it to contact in the desert, I'll give away one pass right now. 323-825-5045. All right. Now, just to recap. Oh, follow us on Twitter, at JChurchRadio, and email is jimmy at jimmychurchradio.com. Is this to recap? There's a couple of things that really need to be stressed here when you're listening to Jason, and that is honestly whether it is an ancient alien contact that we had throughout the millennia, or not, is that we just don't know. We just don't know. And when we look at the evidence that is mounting and mounting and mounting, and before I just say Gobekli Tepe one more time tonight, we just don't know. What we do know is that we have everything in front of us that has been presented over the years, and especially the last 20 to 30 years, that we need explanations for, and we're not given that. And scientifically, if we put all of our resources into the evidence that has been in front of us to start to explain how this was done, when we look at Cusco, and look, we talk about Giza so much, and we talk about Gobekli Tepe, and we talk about Stonehenge. I get that. I do. But when we move away from that and we go to South America and we start looking at these megalithic sites in Cusco,
in and around Peru. There needs to be scientific, hardcore scientific research done in these areas, because there's nothing in a modern sense that explains how primitive cultures carved and formed these stone walls and transported these huge, and I mean, they are huge, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 ton blocks that fit into each other with irregular shapes. There's nothing, when you look at those structures and you try to figure out in your own mind's eye how primitive man did that, you cannot base everything on, you're not giving enough credit to them that all they did was work with stone and they knew how to do it. That doesn't explain how they got it done. Today we have CAD systems. Before we had CAD systems, computer assisted design, before we had that, we had mechanical drawing boards and triangles and squares and ways to measure and compasses, and we drew and we were able to measure and plot out. And that's how we would have to go at one of these walls, with crazy, crazy measurements to make sure that these stones fit into each other as they do today when you look at it. Okay? And we wouldn't do it. It's too much work. It wouldn't make any sense. And then you have to look at, and this is why Jason is so interesting to listen to, is why they did it. When you look at a wall, forget about Giza. Well, put that away. Put away all of the religious sites throughout Egypt. Put that stuff aside. When you look at these walls in Peru, these beautiful, huge walls, you have to say to yourself, why would they do it? Because the amount of energy and manpower that it would take to put that wall together, that's not there as a defensive structure. It's not there for warring tribes, you know, and this wall is built. Why would you put all that effort into it when we need that manpower into crops and animals and eating and survival and building shelter for us here so we can procreate and continue on as a civilization? That's where your energy needs to be spent. But as the leader there, you're going to turn around and go, hey, for the next 100 years, we're going to build a wall. And that's all we're going to do. It doesn't make any sense. And how they pull that off without drawing boards and without plans and, you know, no written language and no way to draw. And it's the same thing at Pumapunku. You know, no written language, right? So how were these plans drawn out? Somebody had to draw this stuff so they could replicate it. And that's where this stuff gets really cloudy for me. It doesn't make any sense. And just going on faith, because that's what you're asking me to do, is just go on faith that ancient man had the ability to do this. So don't question it. They just got it done. They knew how to work with stone. That's not good enough. When you look at those walls in Peru, and when I say irregular, there aren't two stones that are the same. And they're as big as a truck, and they transported them from a quarry 25 miles away or 50 miles away over hills and through valleys, and somehow got them here, and they fit together magically. It doesn't work that way. And today we understand that. 100 years ago, 200 years ago, you see these walls and what, you know, we don't get it, and they're just there and we accept it. But today we know we're smart. So how did they do it without the wheel? How did they do it? You know, melting these rocks to fit together makes a lot of sense. How did they do it? Okay, fine. How did they do it? It just doesn't make any sense. And that is where Jason comes up in spades, is that now we have to stop and question Where did the technology come from? Where did the knowledge come from? Either somebody assisted them or somebody taught those ancient cultures how to do it. And that is where we need to figure this out. Science needs to go in and look at this. We need academia to go in and try to figure this out. But they just won't do it. And I'm here to tell you, when you look at those megalithic sites in Peru, and you look at some of these mirror imaging on how they were able to do this, and then you turn around and you go to Giza and you see the exact same thing, exact, not similar, but it's exact. And that's where you stop and trip out. Wait a minute. You know, now, so, and the reason why I bring this up is this, and Jason brought this up, is maybe our DNA, that knowledge was stored there. That at some point in our development, that knowledge comes out. It just comes out, and that technology is there, and we're able to do it. And those timelines are the same, and they've started doing this on different continents at the same time. A few things popped up around the world that were similar. One, and I'm being very elemental here, something as simple as windows. Windows, square windows. Where did this idea come from? It's here in North America. It's here in Mexico, it's in Giza, and it's in South America. Suddenly windows show up, square windows. Everybody had the same idea in China as they were having in South America. Windows. I know it sounds crazy, but think about that. Stair steps. Everybody had the same idea at the same time and figured it out, unless maybe A, we were taught, or B, it was just in our DNA. Think about that. I don't understand it. I really, really, really don't. But they had the same ideas at the same time. And when we start to take away not only the way that it was done, you know, how it got done, but then we have to stop and take a look at the tools that were used. Because I'm here to tell you, if you go back to the Bronze Age, and you have a copper chisel or a bronze chisel, you're not chiseling any rock. You would be resharpening every time you hit it, bam, with your stone hammer. You're going back and sharpening it again somehow. So you had a blacksmith on site that was cranking out these tools because you're going to hit the stone once or twice, and that's it. It's dulled. You're not going to do anything with it anymore. So it gets complicated. It's not as simple as copper tools and chicken bones and stone rocks. It's not. And we have to start to question everything. And we can't get science to apply themselves to help us out here. I know right now that all of these questions come from alternative historians that want to take a look at this and start to question what evidence that we have here. But we don't have archaeologists, degreed professionals stepping out, you know, Shock is one that has, but stepping out and trying to question this. They just won't do it. And it's either because they can't, or it's because, quite simply, and I know I'm going on the conspiracy trail here, but they just don't want us to know about our past. They don't want us to know. And I don't understand why. And it takes alternative people like, you know, the greats, you know, Graham Hancock and Bevall and Childress and you know, Linda Moulton Howe and Martell, Von Daniken, to go out on the limb and start to present these alternative ideas, because we don't have anything else to go on. It's amazing to me. It really is. Hey, listen, I've got a few things that are interesting here. I want to get to everybody before we close out tonight, because this is something else that is very curious. Last month was the hottest April on record globally ever, and the seventh month in a row to have broken global temperature records. The latest figures smashed the previous record for April by the largest margin ever recorded. It makes 3 months in a row that the monthly record has been broken by the largest margin ever, and 7 months in a row that are at least one degree above the 1951 to 1980 mean that for that month. When the string of record-smashing months started in February, scientists began talking about a climate emergency. Figures released by NASA over the weekend show the global temperature of land and sea was 1.11 degrees warmer in April than the average temperature for April during the period of 1951 to 1980. Now, there are some out there that will say, well, 1 degree, you know, Celsius, you know, what does that even mean? It's not much, but it is a lot. And the other part is, didn't we just come off of the coldest winter ever? So what if we start seeing the two extremes going into the future, right? The coldest winters with the hottest summers. What does that mean? And have we done this before? It's interesting, but the data is there. The U.S. Military Tech Development Agency, DARPA, is testing a special pod drone delivery system that can hide in the ocean until remotely triggered to launch. The Defense Advanced Research Project Agency's upward falling payload, it's called the UFP, is designed to lie in wait on the ocean floor until it's needed or a threat arises. A wake-up signal is sent remotely by U.S. military personnel, and that triggers the pod to rise to the surface where it releases an unmanned aerial vehicle, a UAV, into the sky. Now, to paint this picture for you, you can go over to our Facebook page if you want to see what it looks like. Okay? It's a pod. It's a pod. Drops in the ocean, sinks, sits on the ocean floor forever until it's needed. Signal, boom, switch is flipped. This thing floats to the surface, opens up, unfolds its wings, and takes off. Now, put that in your mind's eye. And you know what's really weird about it? It's a very simple technology. It's very simple. Somebody just had to just follow through on the idea. But it makes a lot of sense, and it's really, really scary if these could be deployed all around the world on the coasts of countries and just sitting there. Nobody knows they're there. And then suddenly one day that switch is flipped and you have 500 of those coming out of the ocean with no aircraft carriers around, no Navy, nothing is there. And these things just pop up. Think about that. And this is the second part. They're cheap. Think about that. Well, ExxonMobil owes the state of New Hampshire $236 million in damages after it contaminated groundwater by spilling a fuel additive. The U.S. Supreme Court declined to hear their appeal. Exxon. The New Hampshire Supreme Court ruled in October 2015 to uphold a 2013 jury judgment that awarded the state $236 million in damages from Exxon in a case involving a spill of methyl tertiary butyl ether, MTBE, a fuel additive containing oxygen that renders gasoline more combustible and less of a pollutant. This is the second MTBE-related case that Exxon has appealed to the United States Supreme Court without success. That's right. They lost once before. Back in 2014, Exxon appealed a $105 million jury verdict based on an MTBE contamination in New York City. Twice. Exxon feeling the heat. Well, in the eastern coastal city of Baida in Libya, there is a vault with gold and silver coins worth $184 million, which belongs to the central bank. Now listen to me. Libya's cash-strapped government doesn't have the code to open said vault. Follow me. Don't lose sight of what I am about to tell you. So, because they don't have the code to open the vault that is stuffed with gold coins, it has hired a pair of safecrackers. Yeah. Okay, are you listening? All right, now let's go to the Jimmy side of this. Because if it wasn't so tragic, this whole story would be comical. A head of the central bank doesn't have enough money to pay for the employees, so he hires these two safecrackers. Yes, I'm not making this up. And on top of it, they want to melt the gold, even though probably they would get much more money if they sell the coins as they are, because people would love to have, in my opinion, souvenirs or memorabilia with Gaddafi's head on it, right? Because that's what these coins have. But because the picture of Gaddafi is on the coins, they don't want to have the political implications that could possibly occur releasing and selling coins with Gaddafi's face. So they're willing to melt them to make less money than as if they're sold as collectible gold coins. The whole thing is nearly hilarious. But Libya's broke, and they're going to do what they have to do. It is one of the craziest stories ever. And now, on other Libyan news, as if that wasn't enough, and you can see the writing on the wall, this goes back to Syria 101, when we started backing ISIS. Now listen to this. Members of the UN Security Council say that they're ready to lift an arms embargo and supply the Libyan government with weapons to combat Islamic State terrorists. This decision is stated in an official communique of talks in Vienna, signed by all five permanent UN Security Council members. That's right, the United States, Russia, France, UK, and China, as well as representatives of over 15 other countries participating in the talks. It comes after Libyan Prime Minister Fayez Sarraj called for lifting the arms embargo to support the National Army earlier today. Now, Libya is in complete disarray. We invaded the country. We bombed them back into the Stone Age. They have no infrastructure. They have no government. They have no police. They have no navy. They have nothing. Nothing. They can't control anything in that country. And it's our fault we did it. I get that. But now, with all of the disarray that's there, we're going to turn around and just send arms to the country? It just doesn't make sense, does it? Now, when I say the writing's on the wall on this one, I'll bet you a dime to a dollar. In a couple of months, ISIS is going to be shooting back with arms that we shipped into Libya. And you heard it here first. I mean, I could just see, it just sounds like a bad idea. It sounds like a bad idea. If anything, and I know I always hate saying stuff like this, but let's just send in our own troops where we're hanging on to our own weapons. If that's what it comes down to, it's our mistake. We did it to begin with. But just sending in arms and drop shipping and sending stuff in on boats and sending it in there, I can guarantee you ISIS is going to be shooting back at us and them with the very weapons and ammunition that we send in to the country. That's it. It's just a bad idea from the word go. You heard it here first. Aight. The CIA's internal watchdog, yes, inadvertently, yes, deleted its only copy of the Senate report on torture techniques employed by the agency in the wake of 9/11, and did so while the Justice Department themselves was insisting in court that copies were being stored. Now, I'll say this again. They deleted its only copy of the Senate report on torture techniques. Other copies still exist, including at the CIA itself. But news of the deletion is significant. As it occurred at the CIA Inspector General's office, which is in charge of overseeing policies and conduct at the agency to ensure that it's not breaking the law or acting out of bounds. Now, does any of this make any sense to you? Although the full 6,700-page torture report has never been released to the public, and I get that, the Senate did release a 500-page executive summary back in 2014, and I get that too. The report detailed the CIA's use of so-called enhanced interrogation techniques, including waterboarding, sleep deprivation, and more, and sparking an outcry from around the world. But now, the only copy of it, the only copy was destroyed at the CIA's own Inspector General's office. Something is funky. And it was the original report. I want everybody to understand that. Well, curators at a British museum have discovered what they claim is the youngest mummy from ancient Egypt. A mummified fetus believed to be 16 to 18 weeks old. Now, how did this happen, you ask? Well, for more than 2,500 years, the tiny body has been resting in a small wooden coffin, the arms crossed over its chest. The coffin was excavated in Giza back in 1907 by the British School of Archaeology and came into the collection of Fitzwilliam and its museum in Cambridge in the UK the same year, back in 1907. Now, until now, it was believed the coffin, which is a little more than 17 inches long, okay? It's small. You can see pictures of it over on our Facebook page. They thought it contained the mummified remains of internal organs. And that's what they did all the time. They removed the organs during embalming, threw them in these small coffins, and wrapped it up. And that's what they thought was inside. But when the curators asked the Cambridge University's Department of Zoology to do a CT scan for a forthcoming exhibition, they were presented with pictures of the remains of a tiny human body. It's absolutely incredible. Go to our Facebook page and check it out. Well, okay, I got to do this really quick. The U.S. military's X-37 space plane is now nearing 1 year in orbit on its latest secret mission. The robotic space plane launched atop a United Launch Alliance Atlas V-5 rocket on May 20th back in 2015. Today is May 16th, kicking off the X-37B's fourth flight. This mission, which is dubbed OTV-4, which is short for Orbital Test Vehicle 4, by the way, remains a clandestine affair. We have no idea what it's been doing up there for the last year. But we have a little clue. Are you ready? Air Force spokeswoman Captain Anna Marie Anicelli said today, "I can confirm that the fourth OTV mission is approaching 1 year in orbit." That's all we got. This is Fade to Black. I want to thank Jason Martell. Absolutely fascinating conversation tonight. Tomorrow night, don't forget, John Rappaport is going to be right here with his imagination presentation. Fade to Black's executive producers, Rita Camarion. Shows produced by Hilton J. Paul, Mark T. Kovar, LJ3, Renee, Mark Dunbar, Jonas. Thank you, Dennis. Thank you, Bob. Announcers are Steve Harder, Gene Vito, and Mark D. Kovar. Fady by Dale. Webmaster is Drew the Geek. Music, Doug Aldrich. Intro, Space Boy, spaceboymusic.com. Fade to Black is produced by KJCR for the Game Changer Network. Syndication, KGRA, The Planet. Tomorrow night, John Rappaport. This broadcast is owned and copyrighted 2016 by Fade to Black and the Game Changer Network. It cannot be rebroadcast, downloaded, copied, or used anywhere in the known universe without written permission from Fade to Black or the Game Changer Network. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Follow me right now on Twitter at JChurchRadio. Email jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. I want everybody to be safe. And one more time, Gobekli Tepe.